এছাড়া
আমি কথা বলছি, চেঞ্জ করবো যে আপনি গুড ডে এভরিবাডি। As I suggested, I mean, let's make it a bit interactive session where my responsibility is to go through the so-called introduction to wireless communications. I'm sure some of you will be wondering why is this introduction necessary really, and it's not that easy for me to explain why it is absolutely necessary. Only one reason may be that from a past experience, we see that the background of the participants sometimes is pretty wide. Okay, like many of you here may have a background in electrical engineering, or to be specific, in electronics and communication engineering, while there may be some who has a background of computer, more of computer science and engineering, okay, or maybe computer science only, or somebody maybe here with a background in core electrical engineering with a little less exposure to so called wireless communications. So, one of the purposes for this introductory session is to come to a kind of level so that the subsequent topics which are likely to follow are better appreciated. Okay. But it is, I mean, easier said than done really if I keep on speaking myself. So, I will fervently request you to ask any kind of question, any kind of question, not necessarily for your own benefit. Okay, I am sure it will benefit somebody else in this audience, including me. Okay, so please ask questions and stop me. In fact, to make that possible, see, my organization again is apparently simple. Okay, what we wish to discuss is some basics of digital wireless communications. Because we assume that when we are talking about wireless communications, and that too short range wireless communications as the theme of this program really, probably we are meaning digital wireless communications. But I am sure there is somebody who can tell me whether analog wireless communication also makes sense. Anybody? Analog wireless communications? Yeah, there are examples like radios, isn't it? That AM, FM kind of radios, okay, fine, and several other systems. But then I will start, I mean, nudging a little bit from right from here, saying that these examples of radios are not true examples of communication systems. They are more of broadcasting systems, where the program is broadcast from one central position, okay, and is received only by most of the listeners. So, to that extent, it is not a true example of both way or two way communication systems. So, when we say communications, wireless communications or short range wireless communications, we mean that, well, there should be provision for both way communications. Is that okay? So, that way radios are not again examples of analog wireless communication systems really. So, would anybody like to give an example of a true wireless, analog wireless communications, both way systems? I am making it a bit more difficult. Yes, please. Walkie talkie, yes, walkie talkie, fine. And this walkie talkie, can we just try to categorize again following the theme of our program of short range wireless communications, whether walkie talkie is indeed an example of analog wireless short range communications? or long range communications. Short, there is one opinion, yes. So, can you just give me an idea about what you mean by short, by in terms of distance? Somewhere there is a notion of distance when you think about a short range communication or a vis-a-vis the long range communication or telecommunications. The word tele as such means distance, isn't it? Yes. So, 100 meters, but walkie talkies work even beyond that. It works even over a few kilometers, okay, in some cases depending on the power, etcetera, maybe it exceeds 10 kilometers even. So, walk line of sight, that is another feature of wireless communications, okay, will follow probably somewhere. In terms of the distance specifically, walkie talkie is this a good example of a short, really short range communications the way we expect discussions? Not really, okay. Like she says that, well, by short range communications, she means a communication over a distance of 100 meter. Is there anybody who supports her or says that no, even less kind of thing? Even less. How much? Let us have an idea about the minimum range where communication is expected. 10 meter, fine. Oh, it coincides, that is good. Yes, anybody imagining even less distance? For 10 meters, you have some examples, by the way. Professor Dotto was mentioning about Zigbee somewhere. That covers 10 meters or even beyond, okay. But is there anybody who may think of even shorter distance and a need for communication over even shorter distance? Yes? IR. Okay. The mode, etcetera, how to do it is the technology part. We will follow a lot during this week. But in terms of broad thinking, really, what may you think is the minimum or the shortest distance of interest where communication is likely to be useful in future, if not yet materialized? Is it restricted to 10 meter? Even in centimeter, that is a great answer. Right? Yes. Mm-hmm. That is a good example of short range communication. Some wireless microphone he talks about, really, where the typical distance that is covered is say anywhere between 4 meter or 5 meter within the room. That is what he mentions over there. But what I was insisting is whether you can imagine the need for wireless communication and where the distance of interest is the minimum possible one. Yes? NFC. Full form is probably near field communication. Okay, you are talking about one idea which is almost, either implemented or people are researching, basically, isn't it? Can you just tell us the distance there and the uses? Ultimately, what for we need that, really, if you know?
So that will be in centimeters, and the usage is basically for e-wallet, online transactions, money transactions by just card swiping through the air.
So he has given some idea about a need for communication over even a shorter distance of a few centimeter. Good. Even shorter distance, if I insist, I am insisting a little bit so that you are pushed to think and think of some useful example. Because in telecom, well, it is so happening now, okay, over in the post Second World War kind of situation, that sometimes the application needs are coming ahead of the technology. Though sometimes the technology has been there and the applications have developed later on, both way it has been happening, okay. But now, with rapid development in technology, with so many researchers like you participating in the game, there is a simultaneous expectation about what should be done for what kind of possible applications while the technology is being researched out, isn't it? That's the scenario. So, given this context, why not you as researchers or interested person, really, why don't you, can you think of even shorter distance need for communication, wireless communications? Does it make sense? See, he suggests, incidentally, that's a very important application, though may not be covered in this program, really, is that of communication among various components in an electronic system, which itself is very compact. You all know that in digital systems are very compact, lot of computations can be done in per cc or per square centimeter, and then some interconnection amongst the components or maybe within an integrated IC itself, isn't it? You are all aware about SOC, isn't it? Okay, so that's one end, which means that there may be a need for even shorter and shorter distance communications, which were otherwise so far done or carried out by using some strips, copper strips or gold strips, etcetera, even within an IC, they may go wireless. They may go wireless because wireless offers certain advantages. So theoretically, there is no limit to the shortest distance, okay, where wireless communication may find application. That's one very good, interesting upcoming example. Another one I was just thinking, because you never stop thinking. Fine, please. Well, I mean, the later part of my discussion was not necessarily to analog communications. I'll come back to that example of when analog communications. I mean, the discussion was now for any kind of wireless communications, both analog or digital, really. Now, his question is this analog wireless communications that I started discussing about, whether it's for voice or also for data. Can anybody help me really? Because what I know is that traditionally, voice being an analog signal was quite in line or amenable to analog processing and eventually analog communication or transmission as well. So, voice traditionally for a long time was processed and then communicated through analog means, okay. Though of late for last 30-40 years, I mean voice is mostly processed in a digital manner, and it is digital signal processing for the sake of compression, etcetera, etcetera, and in it is transmitted nowadays through digital, so called digital means, digital modulation, digital coding and things like that. Okay. So, for voice, now the trend is digital processing. Okay. What about data? Can data be transmitted through analog wireless systems? It's just the bookish question basically. I mean, it may not have much relevance today, because once digital processing techniques are available, that too very cheaply, there is hardly any reason to go back and then send data through analog means. But then the question is relevant depending on the context. There may still be situations where, data also may be sent through analog means. I am talking about sending by analog means, which means the corresponding communication portion may still be analog over there. Okay. Though, for the sake of another very important issue of capacity and throughput, okay, that is out of favor, so to say, really. And if it is data means something digital, either in a binary form of 1-0 or in multi-level form, whatever it is really, again it is quite amenable for processing and transmission digitally. So, you have many digital modulation and coding things you use. If you have data to send from one place to another, you go for digital processing, digital communication methods. Okay. If it is voice, okay, though in the past they were processed in analog manner and were also sent using analog modulation schemes, nowadays they are mostly in digital domain. And if it is data, though you have options really, but for better reasons of assuring higher spectral efficiency and eventually ensuring that higher amount of data in kilobits, megabits or whatever it is really per unit time, per second can be transmitted, by and large data transmission is digital today. Is that okay? Fine. Now, just we will not talk much about analog anymore, okay, neither in this lecture or in the subsequent portion of the course really, but still to complete, this issue of wireless. It is not that analog wireless communications were used only in walkie talkies kind of thing. There have been many long distance wireless communications examples which were analog. Like the senior persons may remember, we did have analog satellite based wireless communication systems. That again is in the other end really, very long distance communications, okay, using analog modulation techniques over there. Okay. That was very popular till about 20 years back. Now, of course, most of the digital wireless communication systems through satellite, they are also mostly digital. Okay. They are capable for taking data, taking digitized speech as well as any kind of multimedia signal over there. Okay. Now, coming back to our topic, one important issue that is emerging is that for short range wireless communications, the actual physical length may be very small, very small. One example has already been mentioned, okay, for short wireless communications within an electronic system, okay. And then the other example that I just want not to miss really, so that you keep thinking, there may not be much emphasis during this program, okay, but then that also may be meaningful if you think and if you try to pursue a little bit really, is that of kind of communication that goes on in live human being or other animals really. Have you thought about that? I am sure somebody has heard about what is known as body area networking, BAN, yes, that is a kind of WAN, man or what, LAN. We have heard about LAN, local area network, okay, MAN, metropolitan area network, there in terms of the physical distance, and then wide area network, okay, there is another paradigm called BAN, body area network. What is that? Can anybody guess or tell me a little bit if you know? Body area networking, a kind of network, okay, largely wireless, okay, where there may be some kind of devices, okay, maybe sensors, okay, or some actuators which can drive some pumps and micro pumps and things like that, okay, attached to for example a human being, isn't it? And these multiple gadgets which may be placed, which may be wearable, which may be implanted, okay, may go around my body. And then the whole network at one level, the lowest level, okay, will be consisting of these gadgets, okay, and then they, whatever they collect, some kind of information, okay, may eventually be transmitted to some kind of access point, which may be located about a meter or two away from my body. That is another situation which is coming up in a big way, okay. And in such situations again, if you think about the distance among the various nodes and devices which may be implanted or I may be wearing over there, the distance is of the order of a few tens of centimeters, like that only, okay. So that may be another kind of networking, essentially wireless networking, where again the distance is to the time of the type of short range kind of thing, okay. And then if you want to think even beyond this, just for the sake of academic interest, because we are talking about wireless, okay, we should not think only about a free space wireless communications. Some of you have heard about what is known as molecular communication, molecular theory of molecular communication. A lot of work is going on there, okay, where I mean some transmitting element, some receiving elements have been conceptualized, okay, and then there is an issue of sending something, maybe a piece of information, okay, from one place to another place where the distance involved is pretty small, okay, and then the method of propagation is much different from free space propagation, okay. So that may be another area. Only point is that you may ask that we are all electrical engineers, why should we be bothered about non-electrical form of communications even though it exists, okay. My suggestion is that, well, don't discard that. If there are potential pockets for research and if you are trying to create, I mean search, if you are looking for new problems, well, don't discard that really, look into that, and you may find that eventually the essence of communication may still be there, okay. For example, one essence of communication as is summarized even in the context of electrical communication is that of capacity of a communication link. Capacity, many of you are, some of you are aware about, isn't it? We talk about capacity very casually. Fine, I said very casually, like do we talk about capacity of your phone or something? If your phone is, my phone is a 2G phone, and if you are carrying a 3G or 4G phone, do you think that, well, your phone has a higher capacity compared to mine? Have you ever thought of that? No? No, I mean you should contradict me a little bit really, should not agree always. See, my phone, if it is a 2G phone, 2G means that GSM, okay, GSM 2G with GMSK kind of modulation format, where for your voice call typically a bandwidth of 25 kilohertz is allocated, okay, and then you transmit, your data rate is not very very high, only a few kilobits per second, okay. Now compared to that, if you have a 3G or 4G kind of phone, okay, then you get a higher data rate. I think that's a more familiar keyword, isn't it? If you are purchasing a higher generation, higher G phone, then you have a higher data rate. But being electrical engineers really, or electrical science engineer, I mean, you have some idea about this data rate, isn't it? And usually the user is happy if he or she is given higher data rate. Why? It's simple, you can do many varieties of things, okay, and whatever things he or she does, like sending some image or even video clipping, etcetera, that takes less time, isn't it? Now, if you think about the background technology which supports higher and higher data rates, then obviously there is a difference in processing, okay, the way bits are processed and then the way bits are taken from one place to another, like from your phone to the nearest tower or base station and vice versa. The technologies are different, okay. And if I am having a 2G phone, maybe that, okay, I purchased the phone long back, and maybe that was the time when only 2G phone was available, only 2G technology was available. Like, you know that 4G technology has been introduced in our country rather recently, and the demand is picking up, kind of thing, fine. They guess that, well, the demand is going to shoot like anything, fine, and before the so-called 5G comes, okay. 5G may come sometime around 2020, that's what is the prediction. What does that mean? It means probably that the technology is not yet ready, okay. And if the technology is ready, can you guess how much time it takes today to bring out products based on that technology today? I mean, I am trying to bring in a few other issues basically, which may not be of your core interest, but it may be a good idea to at least take them in so that they are useful, you understand the perspective basically. What I have suddenly started talking about is a kind of cellular phone generations, 2G, 3G, 4G and 5G, okay. In this program, so far as my understanding goes really, there is not going to be enough of emphasis on 4G, 3G or 5G technology, cellular technology, okay. The much of the theme you will find is beyond cellular technology. Or any of you want some focus on cellular technology? Well, there is enough, a lot of discussion is going on in the country, many books are coming up, there is enough material really. So, if you are focused on tracking the emerging cellular technology, okay, that's very important. There are many outstanding problems, okay, and one can talk about that. But for this program, the focus is not probably on the cellular technology really. There have been many programs here also. We had one such program only very recently on the emerging scenario for 5G technology. The technology is not yet readily available or readily agreed, which means that researchers are still working, fighting amongst themselves, discussing and trying to accept their own technology for some kind of standardization activity. Standardization in telecom is very important. In this program also, you will find a lot of emphasis. And my point is that as and when the technology is demonstrated satisfactorily, okay, I mean, somebody thinks about standardizing it so that the same can be taken by the manufacturers and can eventually be deployed in the market and they are available for usage. For 5G, it is yet to happen. For 4G, 3G, they are already standardized, okay. Full systems are available in other countries for quite a few years. In our country, because of other non-technical decisions, I mean, it's taking time, and now we are seeing deployment of 4G. So, cellular technology development has its own story, very interesting, very intricate, okay. There are many complicated issues to be sorted out over there. For example, in 5G, there are very fundamental issues of modulation and multiple access, resource planning, etcetera, they are not yet addressed successfully or universally. So, a lot of work is going on. However, for the non-cellular domain, like the short-range wireless communications, you may think, while many topics are taken up really, whether it makes sense to bring in that concept of cell even in short-range wireless communications. If I am going fast, you have to ask questions and stop me, otherwise I assume that, well, you are following kind of thing, okay, please ask. Like there was an example some time back where he imagined a short-range wireless communication systems within a room. That was fine, okay. But then if there is an issue of communication within a room, can we think of the room itself being a cell, somewhat similar to the cells that are used, macro cells that are used in outdoor places really. So, whether imagining an indoor cell makes sense, and it goes and it brings in certain advantages, okay, to the design and conceptualization of short-range wireless communications. That's one point actually. there are a few other issues. I mean, in fact, there are many issues in short range wireless communications. I mean, like the technology, the applications may be entirely different, or different kinds of applications. Okay, there may be different technologies, some of which may be available, some of which have to be developed, so that together all of them can coexist, okay, and can eventually serve the purpose of the user. Historically, it has so happened that any technology, any telecommunication technology, or more specifically any wireless communication technology, okay, has been accepted. If it has been accepted well by the user, the technology has developed more in that direction. If it has not been accepted by the user, then, well, though there might have been good amount of research in that particular area, eventually that research has not continued. So that is a very important aspect of telecommunication engineering. So here also, when it comes to short range wireless communications, technology is emerging, though many examples, system examples are already there, some of which we wanted to mentioned over here. But then that is not the end. In fact, the summary is that I just mentioned towards the end basically, that there is an issue of bandwidth somewhere. When it comes to wireless communications, there is an issue of bandwidth, sorry, this bandwidth, okay, and availability of bandwidth makes many things possible. Grossly it is like that, and I think some of you may agree with my statement that if bandwidth is made available, then many applications can be thought of, many technologies can be developed. And this bandwidth is very closely related to that bit rate, okay, fine. Can you just tell me whether bandwidth is an issue for wireless communications? Any of you, from bandwidth is an issue, isn't it? How, I mean, how have you felt it really? Data rate. So you know about some possible relationship between data rate and bandwidth, right? Okay, good. I appreciate. Okay, so you are a technology focused person really. But even if those who are not related to technology, they also hear in newspaper that bandwidth is being talked about, and even at the national level, auctioning of bandwidth spectrum, this, that kind of thing. Okay, it's bringing high value to the country. Okay, and but then there are bidders, sufficient bidders, etc., etc. So all these also give us, even if I don't get into the technology really, some feel that, well, bandwidth is an issue, or spectrum is an issue really. Okay, spectrum, which is broadly a kind of radio resource, okay, radio spectrum, is indeed necessary. And there, for a given spectrum, usually it is expected that there will be some bandwidth within that spectrum that can be utilized for communication, wireless communications. And as he says very nicely, that if the available bandwidth is more, the corresponding data rate that can be supported is more. Is that okay? Accepted by everybody? Okay. So much of my job is actually simple. Fine. So while what I do is that, I mean, I'll just try to highlight that what has been the broad approach to the design of wireless communication so far, and how things have silently been changing, so that if you are now interested in the technology and its analysis and further development of technology, you have to take a different stance altogether. And I guess during this program, you will have a clear feel of that. I'll just mention the issue that is important for you to remember. For example, in digital wireless communications, I mean, this list is taken from a book, many of you may be knowing really. I mean, the electromagnetic spectrum is used, okay, and right from here in this table, it is not exhaustive. This is just a typical example taken from a book, sorry. You can see that frequency as low as few kilohertz has got its applications, okay. Some are legacy applications, discontinued today, but yeah, technically it was there. And then my table covers a frequency range up to say 3 gigahertz, and then 3 to 30 gigahertz as well really. My table is a bit old dated, and I am clear about that really. Okay. It is not easy to keep pace with the changing technology and the changing views. Then some dotted line, and then there is a last line telling you that, well, there is an optical fiber communication as well really. know, have a look at this, okay, and then I'll answer some basic, I mean, some questions really. Let us see, I mean, if you share your views, then we'll go a bit faster, and then we'll try to imagine what may be the bandwidth requirement for the so-called short-range communication. Okay. Now, you may see that for each of these, the bandwidth frequency range is noted, the wavelength is noted. That's a simple calculation. Okay, and then the typical short names are there, and the transmission media that are used. It's not that you have to use wireless or the free space as the propagation medium. Okay, for a between a transmitter and the receiver. Okay, in general, the transmitter and the receiver may be connected through a wire. So in this list, this is a general list of electromagnetic spectrum. Okay, it also includes the corresponding transmission medium, and then some typical applications. The application chart, application column is never closed. That's another good feature of modern day telecommunications. The standards are so designed that there is always scope for new developers of technology to bring in new application ideas. So we should not close, we should never think that, well, whatever application is identified right at the beginning when some system is developed is the only application. It's not, fortunately. Okay, one can add applications. And then in this list, I mean, if you take some time and think about some wireline or wireless examples, okay, you will find that the corresponding frequency is mostly limited to a few gigahertz. Though here I have written 3 gigahertz to 30 gigahertz, it is the lower side that is extensively used for civilian communications. Okay. Now, I know there is good participation from Bharat Electronics. Okay. So, I will be happy if somebody can suggest some frequency band beyond say 8 gigahertz or say 14 gigahertz, okay, which also is of interest, not necessarily for civilian communications. There is a vast domain of non-civilian applications for communication systems, wireless communication systems. Okay, whether a frequency band beyond 14, 15 gigahertz is of interest. I am at this row. At this row, what I am looking for is an example of a communication systems, civilian or non-civilian, okay, which operates at frequency say beyond 14 gigahertz, roughly speaking about midway over here. Yeah, good, one at a time. Yes, Y max, yes, sorry, one second, yes, satellite, Y max, satellite, yes, bit louder. Surface to air missile system. Okay, need not tell us more about the system. Basically, the frequency of operation, isn't it? Okay, so one is that surface to air missile. Okay, I mean some kind of communication systems where one of the transmitter or the receiver, one of the transceivers, okay, may be moving, so that the distance, okay, between the transmitting and the receiving station is changing with time. Okay, kind of mobile system, different from cellular mobile systems. Okay, where he suggests that, well, this may be used, and the other examples are WiMAX and satellite. Okay, in fact, when I said 14 gigahertz, I avoided this 11-14 gigahertz band, which is earmarked for satellite communications. Okay, the other satellite communication band that is a bit exploratory, not fully deployed for civilian applications, is that of 27-28 gigahertz band within 30 over there. WiMAX, unfortunately, is not the very relevant example, because WiMAX is a story. I mean, is a good standard which was developed, which was competing with LTE for quite some time. Okay, but so far as the civilian application in our country is concerned, really WiMAX has not been favored so much. It's the LTE which is coming over there, but the operating frequency is lower than that, really. Okay, it's not more than 5.5 gigahertz, really.
Beyond 30 gigahertz.
Pardon?
Beyond 30 gigahertz.
It's not yet. Not in our country, really. Okay, because there are a few issues, of course, really. In fact, typically, till a decade or so back, really, the frequency of operation was largely limited to 7-8 gigahertz, okay, then 11-14 gigahertz, and then higher frequency bands are rather occasionally used. Okay, beyond 30 gigahertz, well, unless you are very aware of the very recent developments, it was hardly there. That was the situation till 10 years back, roughly. Whereas in this program and elsewhere, whenever there is a discussion for short range communications, you will find a new keyword, millimeter wave communication. Some of you have heard. Okay. Now, look at the wavelengths that are mentioned over here. See, a frequency of 30 gigahertz corresponds to a wavelength of 1 centimeter. And then some of you have heard, okay, and I am sure all of you will be hearing more and more about millimeter wave communication during this interaction here. Okay. Millimeter wave communication clearly corresponds to frequency band even beyond this, even beyond 30 gigahertz. Okay. And then, so roughly speaking, roughly from 60 gigahertz onwards, 200, 115, 10, 15 gigahertz band, what frequency band is under exploration in frequency slots wherever they are meaningful in terms of the attenuation, loss of the signal during propagation, etcetera, they are being explored for varieties of short range communications. The point is that, I mean, there is a push, okay, for going beyond the typical frequency bands of operation, okay, and the short range communication happens to be one possible application where even a new frequency, multiple new frequency bands are being explored for possible uses, and that's an interesting story, okay, will unfold during your stay here. My point is simple. In the next graph, we will see that here is again a few small examples that if you are operating in certain frequency bands, like that low frequency, high frequency, very high frequency, these terms were there in the earlier one really, okay, they correspond to typical frequency bands really, like VHF, and then VHF is from 30 megahertz to 300 megahertz kind of thing, okay, and then if you think about a carrier frequency, are you all familiar with the carrier frequency? Okay. If you have to transmit something from one transmitter to the receiver, usually for convenience of implementation, okay, and also for full analysis, we use sinusoid carriers. Okay. And we are talking about this carrier frequency, and the bandwidth is around that carrier frequency typically. Okay. Now, for this frequency of, say, let us take this example of VHF. Okay, maybe walkie-talkie or some examples. I mean, you have 100 megahertz is a typical carrier frequency. This column is now important. It gives us some idea. These are typical ideas. Not, I mean, you have to look for exact values for specific systems. You expect a bandwidth of 5 megahertz. Note that if you are operating at a lower carrier frequency of say 5 megahertz, you could expect a bandwidth of 100 kilohertz. Whereas if you design your system to operate at a higher frequency such as 5 gigahertz, okay, you may get a bandwidth of 100 megahertz. Okay. And the story of optical communications, at least all of us have heard that, okay, if you have optical connectivity, bit rate is not an issue, you can transmit at a very high bit rate, is not it? So, if your optical carrier frequency is something like this, 10 to the 14 hertz, you expect a bandwidth exceeding tens of gigahertz. So, there is a story unfolding vertically. What is that? Data rate, yes. When if you design your system where you can operate with a higher carrier frequency, then you get higher bandwidth, isn't it? This has happened traditionally in the sense the way technology has developed. Okay. And I repeat that the technology has been developing following theory, good theory. Okay. And I'll mention about the central part of that shortly over there. There he mentioned about data rate. So how do you translate this availability of larger bandwidth at a higher frequency with data rate? It's so obvious that if I have larger bandwidth, I can support larger data rate. That's it, isn't it? Usually the story is like that. But the exact relationship depends on several other parameters. If I have got larger bandwidth, then I can support higher data rate. That's the message. Okay. Then can you just guess what may happen if a millimeter wave frequency band is made available to you with a bandwidth say of 4 gigahertz or 5 gigahertz kind of thing? What do you expect? Bandwidth which apparently has not been available so far in excess of 100 megahertz, in hundreds of megahertz of bandwidth, if it is available for short range communications, then what does that mean really? Oh, it is going to be possible to support a very high bit rate communication over a shorter distance. Why the distance has to be shorter is another part really, but then at least over a shorter distance, because of this large bandwidth, our data can be transmitted at a higher bit rate. Is it okay? A possible application, what may be possible applications briefly? If suddenly you have got a larger bandwidth, okay, being made available, I said suddenly because there is an issue of technology, okay, that's being worked out. Assuming that, well, when so many good people work, I mean, solution will come really. So after maybe over a reasonable time, that kind of bandwidth will be made available where transmission can be made over some distance, and then you have a problem of using that kind of system. I say problem. If I am used to voice communication, then for voice communication we know roughly it needs a few tens of kilobits per second. That's a reasonable data rate for voice, isn't it? Say 10 kilobit per second. Then if I am given a bandwidth of 1 gigahertz or 500 megahertz, what do we do with that? Simultaneously voice data, okay. Voice data, data means what? Data to me sometimes is a vague term, okay. I mean my preference, that's my way really. I mean you can criticize. For understanding, I either talk about a voice or speech, okay, then video, and then data, non-voice, non-video data, okay. In multimedia kind of system, all three are combined in a suitable manner, fine. But even for multimedia signal or full video signal, if you calculate the data rate requirement, well, the data rate requirement is not much. Can anybody tell me, if you have studied or worked on multimedia system development, what? Like H.264 or MPEG kind of thing, typical data rate after all processing of multimedia signal, so that data rate should be supported for sending a multimedia signal captured at one place to another place. How much is that? Right, she says it's in Mbps. Kbps is a hard game there because it's a full motion. It's a full motion video, it doesn't come to that level. I mean you suffer the quality, at least for civilian systems. Entertainment quality is a bit different than, I mean, other systems basically. See, nowadays you have got HD TV and things like that, okay. High definition, resolution matters, quality matters. Now with to retain that quality really, if you think of a few kilobits per second, you lose out really. The technology doesn't allow that really. But to be fair really, as of the present technology, it's a few megabits per second. It's a bit variable depending on the quality that you need, okay. Typically from 1 megabits per second to 4-5 megabits is reasonable enough really, okay. So a few megabits, 5 megabits per second is the data rate requirement for multimedia signal. Now I again tell you that, well, we are talking about a rather short range communications, okay, and what may be the need for such a high bandwidth, okay, so that it, I mean, if it has a data rate capability, I am saying if the bandwidth is a 500 megahertz, how much data rate it can support is something which is to be sort of assessed depending on the modulation transmission strategy, etc. But assuming that, well, if the bandwidth given is 500 megahertz, okay, it can support a data rate of 500 megabits per second, that's fair, okay. And if we have such a link, where I can send signal at the rate of 500 megabits per second, at one end my multimedia signal, full video quality and other things signal with audio punch together, it needs only 5 megabits per second data rate. Are you following? The system promises a very high bit rate capability of say 500 megabits per second, whereas in terms of the application, the typical application is requires 5 megabits per second. What can you do with this is a question to think. Though of course, if some of you have already thought about the issue of continuous availability of the channel or sharing that channel amongst many users, then the answer is simple. That's another aspect of wireless radio frequency spectrum. Okay, usually, okay, the newer and newer situations are such that another 5 minutes is okay. Newer systems are coming in such a way that whatever frequency spectrum or bandwidth is allocated, okay, that is to be shared amongst maximum number of users, okay, satisfying some requirement level, satisfying some satisfaction level of the users. Most of the users should be satisfied, most means say 99% of the users should be satisfied about the quality, okay, and then maximum number of users should be accommodated, okay, as per their requirements, as and when their requirements come, okay, but they will be using the minimum possible bandwidth. That has been the situation in system design so far. And what has happened is a story, you know, that whatever new applications came, they have always been oversubscribed. Cell phone or any other applications, Wi-Fi, you know, Wi-Fi is so popular today, even through your cell phone, which was not initially thought of that way really, but then because of the ease, the convenience, etcetera, I mean these applications have become much popular than they were imagined initially, fine, and hence Wi-Fi standard is still being extended in various forms. Now, the point is that there is an issue of wireless spectrum being shared appropriately, and hence if the multimedia signal that you may develop, you may have a good camera system or something you may love, okay, taking motion video, and then you would like to share it with somebody really, then typically you would need a link which will support a few megabits of data per second, okay, and then if you are given a 100 times that requirement for communication, I mean it is okay, because you will not need this link always. Whenever you have a requirement, though 5 megabits per second was sufficient, but you will use the link for a shorter amount of time and will use the full bitrate and transfer the whole content. Does it make sense? So, many users may use the same frequency band, okay, only in a very disciplined manner. This problem is known as, in general, as louder multi-access problem or radio resource usage problem really, okay, where whenever you have a need to send the motion video or some multimedia signal, the link is provided to you, that much of high bitrate capability, and you should have your material ready so that the whole material can be transferred, okay, over a very short time, okay, though it needs 5 megabits per second, if you are given 500 megabits per second and if you have your material ready for sending, well this can be whisked away faster, and then so you will use the link that is available for a very short period of time, and after your job is done the link will be withdrawn and may be used by somebody else. That is the general philosophy. How it is to be implemented is the deeper part, okay, various multiple access strategies have been developed, okay, but then higher and higher bit rate then using this kind of resource sharing mechanism is a continuous driving point in the design of new systems. So, you should not think that you have done well by designing a system which offers a bitrate of 500 megabits per second. By the moment you design such a system, and if it is cost effective, be sure that it is going to be used extensively, and then somebody will need even, there will be more and more users, and hence there will be a need for designing even higher bitrate systems. So, it is the popularity, it is the acceptance of technology which drives the need for newer and newer technology. That is what is the game in telecom, okay, of late really. It is a good thing, it is good because the researchers and the students will keep alive, will have no dearth of problem, okay, will always have good problems really, and we have to solve that really. Now, sorry, there is a transmission loss, that is the other issue. Roughly, I will end with this. The distance comes over here. You have noticed that there is always an issue of power with your cell phone, isn't it? Fine, you have to charge it, okay. But you also are aware that some newer methods are also coming in. Your newer generation phones are more equipped, or they at least claim that, the developers claim that, well, the charging period is now larger. Isn't it? So, but on the whole, are you happy with this recharging of your mobile phone? No? What do you want? No recharging. Huh? Best solution? Well, this is of course an aim, an ultimate aim, okay, for another group of researchers where they are looking for power management of portable devices. Power management of portable devices suddenly is a very important issue. And I didn't know, I thought, well, power means with a DC, okay, you use a rectifier, half a full wave rectifier, and then get from it, and that's it. And no, no. Okay, there are so many alternative ways now, okay, to collect power in small amount over there, and then eventually can be integrated to your cell phone or other portable devices. I am saying other portable devices included, including the devices for short range communications, so that this traditional mechanism of drawing power from the wall, okay, may also be removed gradually. Okay, power management is becoming very important, and various ways are being thought of. But for short, the devices or systems for short range communications, okay, is one thing where probably they may not need the best form of solution of power management, because as was mentioned by Professor Dattu really, that the short range, many of the short range devices will be attached at your home place or in your office space, okay, with some of the gadgets and devices that we are familiar with, fridges, refrigerator, I mean microwave ovens and other equipment at home, where mobility or movement is not much of an issue, and there may be grid power available. So there will be situations where, I mean, charging of these communication devices is not an issue. Whereas there may be devices, okay, fitted with the short range communication equipment where charging or power is an issue. So it's going to be probably a situation where both the requirements will be there, okay. And then, I mean, I can't detail really. The only issue is that many solutions are coming up. Okay, only thing is that the technology has to mature and it should be affordable. Okay, some have already started coming. But for communication systems, there is one fundamental issue: is that between a transmitter and the receiver, now wireless, imagine free space communications. If the distance increases, what happens? The received power goes low. Suppose the transmitter is transmitting with some power. Power is usually expressed either in watt, milliwatt, or in dBm. Okay, for example, 0 dBm corresponds to 1 milliwatt, 30 dBm corresponds to 1 watt. Okay, now that we are talking about short distance communication, probably we don't need power to transmit power of the order of watt kind of thing. We are actually talking about a few dBms of transmit power, 0 dBm to 10 dBm, maximum maybe to 20 dBm plus 20 dBm kind of thing. That means a few tens of milliwatts of transmission power, okay, which is usually of lower order compared to the cell phone transmitter powers. Okay, some of the old cell phones used to transmit even higher power. Now the point is that if a transmitter transmits some signal with say 0 dBm or 1 milliwatt power, then if the receiver is further away, then my point is that at the receiving end, the received signal strength goes lower and lower. Is that okay? Common sense, because the power from the transmitter goes in all directions. Okay, so as you go away, the power flux density, as they say, okay, that is inversely proportional to square of the distance. Okay, if it is free space, fine. In a typical short range communication scenario, you may not always expect this kind of free space communications. There may be certain other devices, either clear obstacle here or maybe other equipment and structures from where the signal may get reflected. So you have a kind of, even limited to some limited extent, some kind of multipath kind of situation over here, which eventually ensures that the received signal strength is even poorer compared to the free space kind of situation. So if the distance is less, you get good amount of power. If the distance is farther away, then the received power is less, even less. What is the problem if the receiver receives less signal? Is there any problem? Decoding will be? What do you mean by decoding? Sorry, that's a closer one. I'm taking this word because so that I can stop early really.
Received power should be more than the sensitivity.
Yes, there is something called the sensitivity level of all receivers, any receiver, whatever it is. okay, which is roughly related to the noise that is internally generated in the receiver amplifier, that so called Gaussian noise, additive white Gaussian noise, okay, that's which is generated in the receiver amplifier, nowhere else, okay. And then if the received signal strength or power is less, okay, or even comparable, then you know the corresponding receiver does not do a very clean job, okay, in terms of ones and zeros, misdetects. Is that the word? Is that what you are calling as coding? Coding actually is coding is again a vague word, but this process of detection should not be called as coding, okay. Coding is somewhat different in the context of transmission reception. The coding may come in the form of say error control coding, it may come in the form of source coding, compression coding kind of thing, compressing the basic material, or some form of line coding over there, okay. Fine, like scrambling and other things, they have some form of coding, but detection is detection basically, okay? That's against the backdrop of uncertainty of due to noise over there. So this all receiver has some amplifier, okay, that amplifier generates noise internally. The received signal strength should be, I mean, typically say 3 dB more than that, it's a thumb rule kind of thing. It depends on the technology that is used in the receiver amplifier design. So that's something. The word is sensitivity. The receiver, if you are ready to pay more, okay, you if the same mobile comes in various models basically for the same standard, if you are purchasing a higher end mobile, maybe the sensitivity of that mobile receiver is a bit higher, something like that. And then if the signal strength goes low, then the quality of the signal goes bad. Quality, if you judge in terms of how many errors have been made in the bits, etcetera, etcetera, the error rate increases. So somewhere one has to, there should be a limit. The interesting point, let me just mention here, is that you will see that down the line we will talk about some kind of radio range in some context or the other. That is, I am going to talk again in the afternoon. The issue is that the actual distance is not very fixed, okay. There is a soft limit, okay, up to which the receiver can be taken while you still get the signal, okay. And if the distance is farther, then the quality of the received signal becomes so low that the signal is not of ultimate voice or multimedia or data signal is not of acceptable quality. That is the scenario. So power is an important issue. I am just summarizing is that the issue of power, the issue of bandwidth, okay, and utilization of the bandwidth, these are actually very three important issues in general, even without talking about specific technology. And now I will suggest you to be watchful, okay, and in the subsequent discussions, please try to remember about these three issues. What happens to the bandwidth that is being used? Is it large bandwidth that is being used or small bandwidth? Okay. And then how this bandwidth is going to be shared amongst many users? That is a network level issue, is going to be discussed sometime. Okay. And then, I mean, in terms of the power, are you using more than necessary power? Okay. In fact, in wireless communications, I mean, using more than necessary power is a kind of crime today. There is a lot, good amount of theory existing. If necessary, the theory should be extended so that eventually minimum power should be used for actually transmitting the signal over the air. That is a good strategy basically. And fortunately, much of the, I mean, there is a good amount of theory which is already developed, but I mean, interestingly, mostly for narrow band communications. Let me see if I can go there. Just one point I'd like to mention, because okay, I skip this. See, here you will find this, there is one word WB, wide band, narrow band. Okay, no, not this one. It's like this, that most of the communication systems that you are familiar, I'm saying most, but by being a bit polite over here, I may even challenge that, well, please see that most of the communication systems that you are familiar with, they are essentially of the same type called narrow band communications, okay, narrow band communications, cellular, non-cellular, whatever it is, where by narrow band I mean the bandwidth that is actually utilized, the ratio of the bandwidth and the center frequency, that carrier frequency, that ratio is very small. Only a few percent, in any case less than 10%. You can see, somewhere I have that, yeah. the ratio of the bandwidth that is used for sending the signal and the center frequency, that ratio is typically less than 10%. Okay. I have mentioned here only some modulation schemes, but you may think in terms of the actual systems, okay, point to point wireless communication systems, satellite communication systems, all kinds of wireless communication systems, okay, like Wi-Fi, okay, cellular phone, be it 2G, 3G, 4G, see that the bandwidth that is used and the ratio of the center frequency is very small. And the reason is that for this narrow band systems, the technology is mature, has been available right in time, and the theory also is very exhaustive. Whereas, as we saw that, well, there is a tendency, there is a need for moving up the frequency ladder and try to use higher and higher frequency where we can get larger bandwidth. Okay. So, some systems are only emerging. One of them was that so called ultra wideband communication. The other kind of systems, which may be a wideband system vis-a-vis this narrowband system, were the so called spread spectrum systems. Spread spectrum otherwise is a very known technique in non-civilian applications. CDMA is very common again, because it is a kind of spread spectrum has been used in cellular communications. Okay. That CDMA, the CDMA that is used in cellular communications again is a narrowband communication system, you can check for yourself. Okay. But for some specific need, one can use the basic method of spread spectrum, spreading the spectrum, and can generate a wideband signal. That is what I mean when I say that, well, wideband system example may be a spread spectrum system examples. And this ultra wideband was one thing which was much in vogue really, but unfortunately it has not been deployed so far because of again some other non-technical issues, some kind of acceptability issues in the market. But there are wideband systems which now can should be thought of really, where the bandwidth is pretty large compared to the center frequency. Okay. And the time is progressing, technology is also being focused so that more and more wideband systems are brought to design and development. Okay. My suggestion is that please be watchful, okay, during the discussion here, and see for yourself whether the particular transmission scheme is a narrowband system or wideband system. The reason being, if it is a narrowband system, be assured that analysis, theory, techniques for implementation, etc., they are largely available. If it is wideband, well, things are open, pretty open even now, which means if you are thinking for research problem, there are many research problems. Okay. If you are thinking of implementation, you should know about a few key differences in the signal behavior, in the behavior of the same physical environment, simply because the frequency has been increased, the bandwidth has been more kind of thing. Okay. So, my last suggestion would be that try to have an idea or ask, okay, whether the system that we are discussing is essentially a narrowband system or a wideband system. Okay. If you are sure that, well, it is a wideband system, then many things are not yet known, need to be developed. If it is a narrowband system, you may be assured that, well, maybe most of the problems are solved, not too many research problems there probably. Okay. I will stop here. Okay. If you have some quick queries, I can take any queries so far. One last point, I mean, I would have loved to add is that relationship between the bit rate and that capacity. Okay. Maybe my colleagues will take some time later, really, or if you think, if you have any queries there, we can discuss otherwise over there. Okay. Some relationship, if higher and higher bit rates are to be transmitted, how it is related to the capacity of the program, what should be the capacity of the system that will be designed. Interestingly, the theory, the baseline theory, is known to us for more than 70 years now through Sanyal's work, Claude Sanyal's work of, okay, information theory over there. No question. Thank you very much.
So, we are with the small introduction by Professor Shashwat Chakraborty. Let us enter now with the typical and get aligned with the typical headline of the course, the short range communications and understanding its application, usage, its 5 MAC layers, network layers, its implementation issues. The mainstream of the course is starting exactly now. Okay. I will give you the brief introduction about all the available short range wireless communications today. Tomorrow, the design rules, the design problems, the challenges upcoming, and also slowly entering towards the standardization aspects. In the post-launch session, we will be in detail explaining about the standards. So, first half will be restricted only to the technologies, second half I will lead you towards the related standards. And you will see a lot of the overlaps actually in terms of the understanding the technology and then how standards have evolved corresponding to that technology is the plan for today. Okay. So, the course outline will be like this, the brief introduction about the short range wireless communication, what is the meaning of it, then the growth of the wireless communication, in that growth where the short range wireless communication falls into, understanding that, then understand the challenges, classification, the design rules, the future needs for this. We will slowly enter into a wireless local area network or WLAN, which is the most popular short range communications, understanding the PHY and MAC for it and how that PHY and MAC has evolved and changed, modified to address the later on other short range communication technologies like your ultra wideband, Bluetooth, Zigbee. Please remember, short range wireless communication does not mean exactly the short range in terms of the coverage. Okay. Today the whole paradigm is going to be changed. So, do not expect that you are in a short range, you are going to have the applications of a very small data rate or very low data rate, it is a no, it is not really. If we proceed next, so short range wireless communication typically is having a combination of the technology and the system. So, wireless communication is like other wireless communication also, we have to understand the aspects of the both. First, let us start with what are the applications, then what are the related technology we have developed with, and then once the technology is there, how the system development challenges came into practice. And in order to give you a very short and very quick overview where we are landing tomorrow, this is a survey done by the wireless worldwide research forum WWRF. They advise students that by year of 2017, you are going to expect 7 trillion wireless devices coming into picture and serving around 7 billion people. It is not a matter of joke, it is a worldwide survey, and the cities like your New York, Manhattan, Chicago, London, including our Bombay, Delhi, our metro cities like Calcutta and also Madras, they will get the effect of like this. There is no doubt it will happen. So, if this is the growth, so next let us see in terms of the different connections and the devices where we are landing. This is the year wise study, today we are here, and down the line by 2020, the vision is such that by 2020, the most of the market will be consumed by the wireless handsets, okay, led by Wi-Fi mainly. Then if you go here, there are the home connecting devices led by Wi-Fi once again, and finally, the machine to machine communication, these are the three pillars who will be leading in the market. So, the type of the devices, if you try to see, the majority of them will be in the three corners of the triangle. And then other devices like your broadband modems, your enterprise DSL subscriptions, your digital TV connections, mobile consumer electronics and the consumer switched access connections, they will be also partially occupying the market. Now, the question is, we are now talking about a very hyper connective world, hyper connectivity in terms of our social, economical life, day to day life. But how to provide that connection, where the technology is, how to provide the cooperation, how to integrate it with our well known cellular communication, how short range will be a parallel indispensable hand of the wireless communication in future. From here, if this is the situation in terms of the device, so in terms of the data rate demand, it is not only that the devices are populating up, it is not only that the high density network is coming up. Demand is the wireless should also compete with the outside wireless of the cellular communication, short range we should compete with the cellular communication and see the data rate demand. So, dot 11 is the wireless WLAN standards. When they started in the year of 2000, the bit rate was in the terms of the Mbps, few Mbps they started with. Today the same WLAN has traveled a lot, and over the journey they have started asking about the 1 Gbps. 1 Gbps demand was in the year of 2005, 2006, 2007. Today it the demand has crossed 10 Gbps already, and in future by 2020 where are we going to hike our communication the huge bandwidth demand, we do not know really. There is a big question mark, but already this 100 Gbps is a very big milestone already kept in front of the wireless. So, this 5G communications that is coming up cellular, in future it is expected that over wireless we have to give the support of 100 Gbps. So, which is currently we can expect only over optical fibers. So, the optical fiber equivalent data rate is coming up for the wireless communication, and if it is expected to come for the cellular, then you have to develop for the short range, otherwise where the handshaking will happen. In future you are not going to accept, remember that you are getting a 100 Gbps connection when you are outside the building, and once you are entering into the office place or inside the building, inside your home, suddenly the connection is down. So, nobody is going to accept this. There is a very big quality of service issue which is hammering the wireless communication domain, because of which 4G has traveled from the 4G to 4G advanced to 5G, where the demand is. We are promising some technology, we are promising some data rate, we are showing it on the prototype, we are unable to get it in the life, in real life, in practice, we are unable to deploy the system like that. Who can promise is that type of data rate, at least in the cell boundary. So, the quality of service should be provided anonymously, whether you are in the cell boundary, whether you are close to the base station, whether you are at home, whether you are at your office place. So, that demand has switched the whole paradigm of the concept of the short range communication, and already demand has come up that you have to a contemporary service with a hand on hand, it should work with the cellular communication. So, today we are here that it is not possible to understand the demand. If the demand is coming up, how to fit the technology and where the research needs to be done, that really needs to be understood. So, going by that, next is this is the traditional one way of classification of short range communication. We knew that short range means it should be classified over the range or the distance covered. Initially it was like this. If you see the NFC, the near field communication, the distance was within millimeter to centimeter zone. RFID also within the few hundred meters, based on whether you are using a passive RFID device or an active RFID device. Then wireless body area networks, actually this communication is basically, in these days you will see that nice gadgets are coming up to measure your pressure, to measure the different situations of your heart condition, and you are communicating actually with some of the communicating the whole data over the wireless. Okay. So, it is in the medical world. It is assisted by the wireless communication, is termed as wireless body area network. Please remember, we do not mean the body area network by means of the peripheral devices that you are wearing. These days people are implanting the device inside the heart, inside the brain, and they are nicely doing the serve, and they are the life saving devices also we are planting inside. And inside when you are planting, some the data communication mechanism is also implanted inside, and it is really hard to change those devices very frequently. So, the robustness in terms of that and the backup for the power, developing the mechanism of powering up those devices so that they can actively work is a very, very nice and research challenge. So, WAN is there. WPAN, wireless personal area networks, which goes up to your 10 meter of the distance, here actually both WLAN the technology like ultra wide band, electrical technology like millimeter wave technologies, what people are talking about, even the Bluetooth, your Zigbee, your Zigbee, they come and fall into these wireless personal area networks. WLAN is dedicated for 100 meters and above 100 meters, it goes up to 1 kilometer and all. And these days actually WLAN, extended WLAN, they are utilizing for the vehicle to vehicle or the car to car communication. Remember, whenever you are implementing a speed concept inside the short range communication network, you are in big danger zone, because short range communication in the initial days we never thought that we will get a speed more than the pedestrian speed. So people, the thought process was completely different. It will be inside a building where most of the things will be static. So the channel modeling is not expected to change a lot. So the design of the technologies and the design of the systems were aligned to that zone. Whenever I will keep a concept of a very high speed car or a train moving with a speed of 350 kilometers per hour, you are in big danger, because you need to now develop all the signal processing techniques both in the transmitter as well as the receiver to combat those effects of the speed, correct? So whatever we have done in the last decade over this WLAN also now needs to be reframed, now needs to be rethought, now needs to be actually well aligned according to the applications coming up, okay? Wireless sensor networks, this is actually is coming up as a very big wave, because without the sensor networks you can never actually stand on this short range communication zone. Everywhere you cannot put your base station. To reach every corner of the covering zone, it is very highly expensive to put everything on the cellular communication. There are all other issues we will slowly address, because of which you have to rely on the short range communication, which will be based on the wireless sensor networks. Tomorrow your life will be completely is a web of a wireless sensor network surrounding you, okay. You see the concept of the smart home, concept of the smart city, concept of the smart office, concept of your internet of things, concept of your smart vehicular communication. So any connectivity you talk about, you are bound to bring this short range wireless communication at the end solution, wherever a cellular cannot reach, okay. The challenges, so the speed, the data rate demand, it is coming up every fifth year, it is a one order up every fifth year. So technology developed today, it is lasting only for 5 years. This is a scenario of wireless today. So every 5 years basis your demand is changing, system design concept is changing, the devices are also changing. In terms of data rate, power consumption, they simultaneously, if one is up in terms of the data rate, the demand is up. In terms of the energy consumption, the graph is down. So you provide me more data rate, but with less energy consumption, because you are providing me over the short range. So if the energy consumption is coming low, so another demand is coming up. You reduce the cost, you minimize the size, you minimize in terms of the hardware component, you minimize in terms of the hardware used inside, you minimize in terms of the total packaging of the device, so that I can easily handle, it should be a handheld device, easily I can carry it, easily I can put it, easily the network should be established. So can you imagine the demand of the flexibility coming up associated with this kind of the applications? It's not about the data rate, it's about the extreme flexibility. It's not the flexibility of the spectrum usage, it's about the flexibility of your carrying, if it is a about day-to-day life related with the way we see our life in future, is actually dominating the research in this zone. See, one good part is in all that, that short range wireless communication easily can take care of this load, because most of the short range wireless communications, they utilize the license free spectrum, license free zone. So the per bit transmission, it has the basic plus point that the per bit transmission is extremely low, okay. Now your task is to further minimize that cost and develop a very good cooperation mechanism with the cellular network, okay. This is another general classification of this short range wireless communication. Forget about this range basis study. Now see the other way we can do it. If I look for the physical layer, the air interface that is already used, it is deployed also. Existing technologies are using from narrow band to ultra wide band, 2 millimeter wave 60 gigahertz communications. For everywhere, starting from the narrow to medium to wide band to ultra wide band, everywhere the short range communication is there. Already people have come up with. If I go by the network and also in the optical wireless communication, if you do for the visible light communication, infrared communication, they are using the optical technologies for the communication. Going by the network topology, we are having two different structures. One is the centralized, another is the distributed. Both way you can develop the network, think the network and actually design the protocols for it. Then is the mobility. Fine. Yesterday we were with the fixed. Initially we started with fixed. Yesterday we introduced the pedestrian speed, nomadic mobility. Today we are thinking of high speed bullet trains. You give the connection with the for that. So you forget about that. There is no comparison actually. Whatever the requirements you can think for the cellular communication, everything is there, whole load is there on the short range. See, there is a data rate. I already told that this few kilobit per second is for the sensor networks. Moderate data rate is for the WLAN kind of the activities, your file transfer, your voice over internet protocols and all that. But very high speed of the 10 Gbps and all are coming up for the multimedia applications tomorrow. You wish to do the streaming, high definition streaming you want. You wish to pass the download actually something from the YouTube at a very fast rate. You have to just transfer your own videos over the net. Everything starting from the short range, it should be picking up. So, data rate, range, your 5-layer occupancy, I should say, your mobility and your topology wise, there is a versatile area and the diverse field that you have to cross over. Okay. So, I would like to, before entering into any technology, let us understand if this is the scenario coming up and today we are standing with it. So, what are the design challenges and what are the top 10 design rules we should follow when as a researcher, as a normal people who are studying in this field, we should start with. By the way, please don't mind to knock me and stop me if you are having some query. Okay. So, short range technologies tomorrow, even today, you have the multiple technologies, radio access technologies in your mobile phones and the smartphones. Okay. You don't use only the 3G or 4G. How many of you are using only 2G or 3G in the mobile phones? Only 2G and 3G. Only 2G, 3G, and so rest of you are using multiple radio access technologies. It means, I mean, you can access WLAN. You have the WLAN enabled in your mobile phones? Yes or no? You have the Bluetooth enabled in your laptop? Yes or no? You have. People who are in the industry specifically, they are also utilizing the ZigBee inside in the industrial area. If people are from the railway, they are using the GSM-R technology inbuilt in that. Yes or no? They are having. So, your mobile phone has become smarter in the terms of the way you can switch over the multiple technologies. Clear? So, it is becoming a multimodal device. Your cellular phone is not only a phone who can give you the communication over the cellular networks. If this is happening, so earlier the concept that the technology like Bluetooth and infrared will give the basic cable replacement, that idea and of the idea has changed its paradigm. Initially when Bluetooth came up, they thought that look, we will reduce the background cable here. So, from my laptop or from my desktop, directly I will give the instruction within the 10 meter distance, printer should be connected and printout should come out. That was the application only, nothing else. It is the cable replacement technology. Infrared was developed to give you the close identification. You are entering into your office. Actually, if it is not a biometric, you will be given the card, you put the card, actually your authentication will be validated. So, it is a local authentication system, the way IRDA came up. Today, this technology is saying that I can support higher data throughputs, I can provide multiple access, it can provide the advanced services, and if these are there, I don't see any difference from the fundamental structure of the cellular communication. If I compare the short range technologies with the cellular. Okay. then the connection that is coming up, this is very interesting. Coming up is that there will be a mobile social network based on the short range technologies that will enhance the existing social networks like Facebook and all, and lot of the networks like that on the experimental basis it is working. I will give you the example. It is working in the university places where the whole Facebook information is getting collected via the Bluetooth over the social network over the social network which is developed over the short range. Clear? So they are actually becoming another milestone or the pillar of the social mobile network, is becoming a pillar of the main social network that is there using the cellular communications. Second is the access over the wireless sensor networks. If tomorrow we are trying to get a hyper connectivity where everywhere the wireless sensor networks are there, so who will connect these sensor networks to the central part? So that inbuilt, in between those two the connection is required, and that is coming up. Third is building the cooperative wireless networks. So this cooperation mechanism to bridge up the connection between this sensor networks and those cellular, and the cooperation mechanism the way it is coming up. So the application wise, if I try to see, you know, in tomorrow you will see that all the SRWCs will be point to multipoint. Interaction between SRC and other networks are essential, and networks, all this connection will be over the towards the cellular network is mandatory. These are the application scenarios. Here we were at the beginning, cable replacement directly between the printer to the laptop or your device, short range device to the laptop. Tomorrow the social mobile network is coming up, all the independent nodes I should say, or your mobile phones who will be connected over the social net, they will form their own social network. And each of these nodes, they will be having the connection with the autonomous sensors. So like that, if each of them are connected with the sensors or the sensor network itself, so sensor network is a definite identity, it is an independent identity, they are the sensors, are there, they are having their own kind of the networks. Now the another short range node, he is actually controlling or commanding over this another smaller zone of that sensor networks, and these guys, when they are collaborating with each other, they are in the cooperative mode, they are forming the social mobile network. Now the greatest part of it is, if this is your mobile handset, it is having the multiple radio access technology. So now if I just switch the mode, I can get connected with the wireless base station, 4G or 5G base station, or I can get another AP connected to it who will actually lead me to get connected with the internet. So how now the things are going on? One is the overlay network going on, there is something underlay network going on. Overlay versus underlay network, if they can cooperatively operate, you see the resource now you are having in your hand, it is huge. So this resource management is a very nice part that is coming up for the wireless technology. Not only the resources, resources means in terms of the bandwidth also, the bandwidth which is available in the short range and bandwidth which is available in the cellular communication, if I can nicely combine in a cooperative manner, the bandwidth has increased. We are shouting for the scarcity of the spectrum today. If cooperation comes like this, then the spectrum scarcity is not an issue. It's a management of the resources, they are becoming an issue. Okay? Not only in terms of resource, now think of the data rate. So the data rate that these guys can support and the data rate that the network can support by the cellular network, they are becoming aggregation, they are in aggregation. The total throughput of the network, this cooperative network, that is enhancing. So the capacity of the network you are enhancing. Another thing is the extension of the range. So wherever cellular network, the boundary, it is the power transmission going on. So the power up to which you can reach beyond the range easily can be extended by this kind of the social networks. So range extension, resource extension, data rate enhancement, and hence the support of the multiple applications, joint applications that are coming from the cellular as well as for the short range, we can address jointly. So these are the applications and whatever I have explained, and remember this last figure, we call it the wireless grid, and this grid is a heterogeneous combination of the heterogeneous network. We will do a lot of discussion on this wireless grid, because that's the only future for the whole network and the whole communication, wireless communication I should say in general. Now, let us enter into the top 10 design rules. These were the problem statement, understanding what is coming up. Design rules, if I start with, there are a lot of the design issues, and they are specific to the kind of the system you are going to design, where you are designing, other constraints of that environment itself, purpose itself, service you are trying to address. Keeping all that aside, in general there are top 10 rules that you have to follow. Number one, communication architecture. We have understood the architecture wise, it should not be only point to multipoint. It should be point to point as well as point to multipoint. The provision for switching for each and every node of your network should be of these two types. Jointly, they should be able to capable of addressing the point to point communication and, if required, point to multipoint communication. Some of the communications today you will see only they are allowing the broadcast, or they are allowing the unicast, or they are allowing the multicast communication. Even for the multicast communication, it is a unicast channel wise that they address from the central base station. If it is a multicast communication for a group of people, even then it addresses through a multicast, not a multicast channel, it is a unicast channel, because aggregation is not possible the way we develop the technology. Tomorrow we should have the aggregation capability of this independent unicast channel, so that when multicast is going on, you can actually really speed up, your channel bandwidth is aggregated. So, whenever I am talking about the peer to peer communication or multi point communication, I mean to say the resource aggregation should happen. The concept was there, I will have either broadcast mode or unicast mode or multicast mode, but the way we were doing it, that was not correct, that needs to be rectified now. Second is the energy awareness. We understand that fundamental challenge here is, see, all are the battery driven devices are. So, by default you try to minimize my energy consumption, that is the fundamental demand of any user. Apart from this, actually if you are energy consumption is high, problem is your operation time will be less. If your operation time is less, who will have the major objection? Not only users, somebody else is also there. Hey, speak up, somebody was telling something, right? Yeah, please, ma'am, please speak up. Yeah, definitely, because he won't get the money for the longer period, right? You are not using for the longer period, where from I will get my revenue? So, both way it is not actually acceptable. I mean, if you are your energy battery is going down for each and every moment, and once you are not up, you are not able to use my operation, my service, so I am not generating revenue from you, so I am not ready. So, from the service providers as well as from the user side, you minimize the energy consumption, so that actually the length of the service and the life of the battery, it should be prolonged, at any cost it should be prolonged. Now, the solution is, and over the short duration, if you are energy consumption is high, definitely because of the small form factor and all, it will be heating up your device, so that is also not demanded. Solution that you can do, it is multifaceted kind of. In the 5 layer, you develop such kind of the technologies through research, which consumes the less transmission power. In the receiver, you develop the energy efficient all different kind of the radio technologies. I mean, the starting from your synchronization block, channel estimation block, your decoding, any other kind of the techniques, suppose if it is MIMO, so the MIMO identification and all. So, all the signal processing you can actually do the energy efficient design, so that is a part of the signal processing. But problem is another else, anywhere, anyway somewhere else, suppose you are designing something in the MAC, so you do the channel allocation in such a way that it always addresses the problems of the PHY. Now, you are designing the routers going up, so why are not you aware why what MAC has done, what PHY has done. So, whenever today we are talking about the energy consumption per bit, it should be per area, and then it should be a joint optimization of PHY, MAC and the network. We never talk that this is the power energy consumption per bit sitting in the phi. Calculating that, what is the modulation scheme I am utilizing, what exactly is coming up here, what the exactly per bit energy consumption going on in each and every block of my receiver. The concept has totally changed. You jointly tell me what is the power consumption when actually bit is really going through all the layer. There is the idea of the energy consumption coming up, fine. So, when I am writing energy consumption, it is a really very big pain for us as a researcher, because some of us are very good phi experts, some of us are good MAC experts, some of us are network experts. The network experts doesn't understand what is phi doing, and we really don't understand how the MAC and network is working. So, cooperation is not required only in the network. Cooperation is required among the researchers who are working in this different zone. You break the concept of the OSI structure and then start working, okay. There is the challenge coming up. So, it is a layer aware system design, I should say. It should be a joint optimization. You will see the speakers later on will keep on addressing this issue. The joint concept of the joint optimization of the layers. Understand and actually your environment aware system design. So, the devices are coming up intelligent and intelligent day by day. You are thinking everything will be done by them. So, but then they should be intelligent. In order to make them intelligent, you have to be intelligent in that sense. So, where this intelligence in the system design coming up? This is a very simple example that the different wireless technologies who are already operating in the market in terms of their power consumption in transmission, reception, and when they are idle, they are consuming the power. And remember, at least 10 times reduction in the terms of power consumption is the demand today. Going towards the signaling and traffic channels. See, we understand that we have to minimize the energy consumption. Then also we have to speed up. So, in order to speed up and then minimize the energy consumption, best thing is that you never allocate the control signal transmission and the data signal transmission through the same channel. What will happen, you know, if somebody is hacking your channel or blocking your channel or jamming your channel, or because of the interference profile, multiple users are simultaneously trying to access the channel and interference is really high, your actual data signal getting blocked, somehow you can manage by retransmission. But control signal getting blocked, you can't do anything, because that's the control information going about the network. All the nodes to whom you wish to connect, they needs to be synced. So, control information is really very, very important part for us. If we miss the control signal, the communication can never start with. So, control signal, we prefer to dedicate the control signal channel and you pass it, and that should be highly dedicated channel. Heavily actually highly secured channel, security should be provided there, so that we can start establishing the network and then you use the data channel and pass the data. So, it is becoming mandatory that you separate out the control channel and the data channel. 4G has already done it in the latest recommendation of 4G plus. They have separated out the control path and the control plane with the data plane. In short range, we are yet to do it. And in the future standardization effects, we have to incorporate. Secondly, you should use the slotted channel. Never allot any TDMA kind of structure is sometimes okay, fine. But if you are giving a slotted kind of the information, slotted channel concept, two parts you got there. One is you can energy efficient point you can handle very nicely. Second thing, actually the resource management you can do also very nicely. So, slotted channel allocation is a very good way for it. Now, something like that, in order to save the energy, it is a signal, though it is a signaling mechanism, but targeting towards the energy efficiency. Suppose my device can have the four different stages. I am transmitting, I am receiving, I am idle, I am sleeping. There is a basic difference between idle and sleeping. Ideal means the level of the power consumption, you are ideal, you are not neither doing transmission nor receiving something, but you are listening simply. Suppose you are on, your whole receiver chain is on and transmitter chain is on. So, continuous power consumption is going on inside. There is a huge wastage. So we don't prefer anybody these days to be idle, to go to sleep. Okay, sleep mode means actually it is a very lower amount of the power consumption going on. Only the first one or two blocks are on, and you will be giving a trigger signal to wake you up. Okay, that's the situation. Now question is, how this waking up will happen? Two processes are there to wake you up these days. One is actually the coordinating fashion. Another is the overlay concept. Overlay concept is something that it is a heterogeneous network we are talking about, right? Cellular communication is there inside your short range wireless communication is working. So all the short range nodes have gone to the sleep mode, suppose, or the portion of the area they are in the sleep mode. Who will take the responsibility to wake them up? The server of the cellular communication, he will initiate an energy signal which is enough to wake you up, and via the whole path of the cellular communication, it will enter via the router of through the short range, and they will wake you up. That's the one condition. Problem is the latency, the time is required to wake you up. Why can't you do it locally? How to do it locally? You come again in the cooperative mode. You understand that suppose in this area, office area, suppose 10 WLAN users are there. Okay. Suppose they are not doing anything at this moment. So what we'll do, you will allocate two of them to be responsible to wake up the others. Others can really go to the sleep mode, two of them will be in the ideal, and he will be continuously listening what AP is saying. So when actually the waking up signal will come, this is a special signal designed which will come in the beacon period during actually broadcasting mode. So just analyzing that, those two guys know very well whom they should wake up, and they will just send the signal to only those people to wake them up. So this is a cooperating mode, but problem is if you dedicate always two volunteers in the network, their energy consumption is going down. So that volunteer action should be also rotated. So randomly allocate the volunteering operation in the network, tell those two guys to take the responsibility of waking up the others. So as a whole, the whole energy consumption of the network will be coming down. Next is coming up the scalability and the connectivity. Scalability is a mandatory issue. So scalability in terms of today you are here as a node, tomorrow if I tell you to connect to more nodes, you should be flexible to do that. Okay, and that's why the scaling up and increasing the network size, I mean the in terms of the coverage and all, it should be very, very flexible. Scalability is now the mandatory design rule for short range communication. You cannot actually, energy consumption and the scalability issues, you cannot actually avoid when you are starting with. Connectivity, definitely. If your scalability is up, connectivity is definitely high. So I should say connectivity is a byproduct of your scalability capability. Next is the medium access control. Medium access control should support this deep sleep mode. Now we have talked about. Your medium access control should be always slotted for the energy perspective mainly. He should have a very quick exchange of the protocols for self-organization. Remember, I will talk the problem here. See, if you see the traffic structure of a short-range wireless communication, you will see neither the architecture is having a concrete frame kind of, any kind of the architecture design connect in terms of connectivity you can very high speed you can develop. At the same time, once the connectivity can be changed at any moment and the new development can be done, the same time your self-organization capability is coming up. See, today you are working as a node, tomorrow you will be a leader of that whole group. So you should have the capability of sometimes working as a central part or as an AP, sometimes as a node to form the network. Something like that is going on. If this is coming up, then very quick protocol should be devised, and very fast message transfer should happen to you that now you are going to be acting as a volunteer, you should be going to act as an AP, you are going to act as a group owner, something like that. Okay. If it is a peer-to-peer communication, then you will be working as a group owner. If it is a small infrastructure BSS kind of, then you are a AP. If it is you are working as a node, I mean the outgoing node of your network, then sometimes you are serving as a router. So, very fast message transfer is required, and MAC should ensure that, your MAC design should ensure that. So, this way the self-organization is coming up into picture. Presence means you should declare that you are there, otherwise how actually your responsibility will be given. So, your presence, the responsibility in terms of the presence in the department or in your workplace is similarly coming in the concept of the network design. So, you should keep on declaring I am present. Okay? So, for that also the way AP declares in the broadcast mode that this is the structure of the network, sometimes some time is given also to declare that the nodes are declaring by terms of their terms of beacon that I am there. Not only he is saying I am there, he is also saying what is my capability at this moment, what is the bandwidth channel left for my transmission, what is the amount of the battery power left in my transmission, what is my capability of maximum giving you the data rate and all, what is my capability of working as a router or as an AP or as a group owner or only as a node, what is my capability, signal processing capability he is declaring. So, see if this is known, it is very easy to choose the nodes to form a typical kind of the application and the network. Suppose cooperation is going on, it is on the fly, dynamically the nodes are getting selected, who will be cooperating for transmission of the high data rate video, YouTube video. So, where will be the paths? So, identify that, you should know the capability of the nodes. So, you choose the path like that, it is not the shortest path. If it is only the shortest path led by, then you will be choosing the wrong nodes, correct. So, the presence and declaration, it is very much required. It is also associated with the service discovery. Service discovery means some nodes you can dedicate for transmitting the management information and the control information. So, what is the capability of yours that you are also your service capability you are declaring. It is a part of the presence, declaration of the presence I should say. Security, you will see that in the whole course we have kept a dedicated session for the telecommunication security. We are really becoming insecure in our social life, day to day whatever is happening outside, not only in our life, the same problem is there in the telecommunication network architecture I should say, because everything, all the intelligence slowly is going to the internet. Okay, we are day by day we are becoming dependable on the internet, and the supporting architecture who are giving you the internet service, they are becoming vulnerable to the security issues. So, the way we are really becoming very serious for the outdoor communication and cellular communication security, because short range is becoming another pillar to support the cellular communication, security issues actually same way it is getting implemented here. So, designing of the security protocols, remember few days back we used to think the security means it is the file layer, lower layer security. Today we do not think it, we try to provide the security starting from the network layer to the file layer. That HTTPS, that means the WEP based your protocol design, it came little bit later. Earlier the concept was not that, earlier we were thinking that if the modulation coding is really very nicely designed, then if your coding is very strong, if I encrypt it somehow very nicely, so it is secured. Today it is not. Flexible spectrum is required because you are talking about cooperation, right. So, my nodes should not be dedicated to use only the Bluetooth zone. If I really can utilize a 2.4 gigahertz free zone, sometimes actually I should be also switch to the 900 megahertz zone. If my capability supports, I should be always be switching to the 5 gigahertz zone. Okay? So, if this is the situation coming up, a very nice technology that fits into this application is your cognitive radio. So, cognitive radio today is not a separate field of the research, already the short range communication and wireless for tomorrow, they have actually also taken him as a friend and a brother to come and integrate, to be integrated over the software over the short range communication specially. So, the spectrum sensing, you have to be having a mechanism of the spectrum sensing, quick switching over the channels, and then actually declaring your presence and capability in the network, very fast pass the information over the MAC and then generate the network, develop the network on the fly. That's the demand, and all this should be done at an ultra fast speed. Clear? Software defined radio design, it is nothing but to support this flexibility on the spectrum. The way you are hopping, the way you are aggregating, where is the hardware to accommodate it? Software radio design is nothing but the development of that hardware, who will support this cognitive architecture. Fine. Any question up to this? Good. This is a very general top 10 design rules, actually tabulated in a terms of a table, where actually we will see the different advantages, scale in terms of the scalability and all, where the which one out of this top 10 design rules, which is most important, where is more mandatory, where you can accommodate, where you cannot, like that. You can have a quick look on this. So, tomorrow's world. The gist of this is, we are entering into a internet of things. The world is becoming an internet of things. If it is there, the main characteristics of that will be huge number of the machines, huge number of the machines connected with each other, hyper connectivity, high speed, like the mobile, not only mobile in terms of our pedestrian speed or the vehicular speed. It's the speed of actually your high speed bullet train that is also incorporated. So, in the high speed bullet train, how will you provide the communication inside the train? So, from bogie to bogie, and when the two fast trains are passing by, interchanging the information, that kind of the application have come up. So, they are the part of the short range communication. So, mobility connected with the machine to machine, if I say, that is the situation when actually it will go on. Real time operation is very, very important, that we are today, we are doing the live streaming of to YouTube, right? The real like that actually everything we want in a very ultra high speed. Ultra high speed means if you are merging towards a real time applications anyway. So, fast information transfer, if this is the fundamental criteria, you have to be in the real time operation. Intelligent, our devices are coming up, and the need of applications, the need of the demand of the next generation, our youngsters, their demand is changing, means very fast speed. So, keeping in mind all this, the solution that we have to find today and tomorrow, that should be of low cost, extreme flexible. You give me the speed, but remember, you have to give me the reliability. So, security. You give me everything with security, okay? Actually, basically, we want everything in life. That's the point, and that's the way the technology is moving. This is the fundamental bottom line. If we wish to go that, so heterogeneous network architecture that we are moving towards, then the different application, each of these heterogeneous architecture, they have their dedicated service, they have their dedicated application, and they have their dedicated reliability, responsibilities, responsiveness, the power consumption, mobility, the way they respond and all are different. And remember, tomorrow you cannot actually come up with a technology which will say you actually throughout all the existing stuff, means throughout your laptop, throughout your existing mobile phones and all, because they are using the old kind of technologies. You should be having a backward compatibility. Whatever is existing, based on that you come up with this new assessments and you aggregate the all the applications that are coming up, and then you provide the backward compatibility. After over the time, actually all those old technologies will be automatically switching off from the next generation handsets. But at this now, we never provide some technology solutions which will tell you discard everything from the market. So, tomorrow if 5G says you just remove all the base stations of 4G, it won't work, right? Like that, 2G, 3G base stations are also working. So, you have to keep in mind that we are demanding that, keeping in the pace with the back whatever our ancestors have done. So, on the base on that, you please proceed. Yeah. side effect. What do you mean by side effects? Not all the, you know, that's why I'm saying it is a heterogeneous network. Depending upon the demand, where somewhere it is a wireless sensor network based sensor network is forming, somewhere it's a low power, ultra low power Bluetooth based technology is forming the network, somewhere the Zigbee based very low data rate based some network is forming. So actually see the situation. Suppose tomorrow in my smart home, my fridge, my geyser, my washing machine, my CCTV camera and my laptop and maybe actually something else, whatever you can think of, okay, my micro oven, everything I have connected via some sensor network. I can develop a protocol of my own because 2.4 gigahertz is a license free zone I have developed. So nicely actually they are connected and finally they are getting connected with my mobile phone. So whenever I am not at home, I can see what is going on in my home. If my tomorrow actually I have left my home keeping my geyser on, and so if the master node at that moment is my fridge, he should knock me that he, hey, your geyser is on, and he should have the responsibility that on behalf of me he can switch off my geyser. So that is the application coming up for the smart home. If I tell you like this, then the CCTV, the data rate of the CCTV transmission, data rate of actually the communication that is happening between your fridge to your geyser and the fridge to your microwave oven, the amount of the data, mode of the transmission, sometimes it is burst, sometimes it is continuous. So you do not know actually what is going to happen. So the application, response time, reliability, your service provided, they are not same. Problem is you have to now deploy a cooperative overlay structure so that all these can be accommodated. Okay. What do you mean by the side effect is you are worried about if I am moving towards a very high frequency zone of operation, whether the side effects on the from the electromagnetic wave is coming or not. It is there, it is there. If you are moving towards the 60 gigahertz and above that, whether we are going to implement it there, whether they are having some problem on the human lives or not, what kind of effects are there, the RF frequencies on the human lives or not, that study is going on. But still after all that, the devices are coming up with whole protection. So the, I should say the hardware components, they are taking care of absorption of this. It is always will be demand based. In future, no. Today Reliance is giving you the service, your whole network is service provider dependent. Tomorrow you will select your service provider. So it will be user dependent. So user driven network is coming up. That's why all are in danger. Why this much shout is going on outside everywhere? Because tomorrow the whole leading power is going to the user. User will demand, they will control the network. Okay. So it's actually heavy, highly flexibility is the main issue that is coming up based on which actually this kind of questions are coming. Where to address it, where to not address it, where to put it and where to not put it. It will be heavily customized design. And the flexibility should be there from the network application to the network to the transport to the protocol design to up to the MAC. Who will allow you to do it? Okay. So next, so these are the issues already we have developed, already discussed also. So I am moving from here. This is a very important concept. When ITUT they discuss about this kind of the application and the situation, they said in gist we can explain the situation as 5 C's and 5 N E. Means 5 C means convergence, content, computation, connection and then communication. The network should be based on all these 5 C. Convergence in terms of the issue that I was saying, the cooperativeness and heterogeneity of the stuff. Content is really very coming important, that is why the security issues are coming into added to it. Computation, very fast movement, so that actually self-organization is possible. Then actually is your connection, how fast you are moving from a sensor to your Bluetooth, to your WLAN, to the cellular. So how fast you can move. Then is the communication, fundamentally the architecture, the radio technology, who will take care of all this movement. what is the technology and what is the system and what is the demand, how to match all this. Any, five any means, you want your network to be anytime present, anywhere present, any service that you can demand, he can give, any network you can go wherever you wish, and any object also, the, if you are having in mind, based on that, you can change the network structure. Okay, seems to be dreaming, right? But it's going to happen. It's not a dream today. No, application, any service that you want. Service provider, forget, they will be a secondary. It is you who will demand the network, actually control the network. I demand this service means service provider should be able to give this. If they are not, let him actually talk to another service provider who can give this service, and they will be in the cooperation somehow. I don't know how. I really don't wish to know. So the concept like your dynamic spectrum sharing, spectrum auction, online spectrum auction. So today, few days back, have you seen in the paper that BSNL and your Reliance, something like that, they have actually signed some MOU. These guys can use the spectrum of those guys can use the spectrum of these guys. These are happening. Why is it coming up? They have already gone the heat. They have already understood the heat of the next generation. They, for their own existence, they are doing it. If, because some of the services are really very nice in the BSNL because they are the government organization. Some of them are really very good in the Reliance. Everybody has not developed their network to support this kind of the high demand from the users. So now if they don't cooperate among themselves, tomorrow none of them will be there in the business. So this is the situation happening. So cooperation is everywhere. Short range wireless communication, if we try to position it, in terms of the distance and in terms of the data rate, both way, these are the very well known technologies that are there. Out of all that, we will talk about in this today's talk, in this first half talk, we will quickly go through the Wi-Fi, ultra wideband, and Zigbee, Bluetooth, more or less here. Millimeter wave and all, I will just touch in the next session when we will enter into the understanding the standardization activity, and there we will also revisit all of them. RFID I have not touched yet because the restriction of the usage very little, and we understand all that, the way actually it will operate, because RFID will be heavily integrated actually with the Bluetooth and the Zigbee kind of application tomorrow. LTE and beyond, all the cellular communications, actually it is beyond the scope of this short range communication today, so we have just kept them apart. Because, but remember, every time we are going to tell how actually we are in this zone are associated with this cellular communication. Definitely, that's why I'm saying. Actually, how to control the overhead? That's why the control channel is becoming separate from the data. Otherwise, the whole data channel will be blocked always. That's the system. Yeah, it is expected to come. How to do the resource management and the protocol designed to address that is the research issue. Do you feel it is really very easy for us to design the network architecture who is completely flexible and moving here and there? So it is a total paradigm change, that's why I am saying. So if I see the way 2G to 3G to 4G we have progress, no, we have just look for the spectral efficiency. You go for the spectral efficiency, it just increase the data rate. When up to 4G everything was over, then the demand came suddenly jumped, like 4G to 5G, if you see the demand, it is a kind of a very huge jump in terms of the demand, and that demand has led, actually they have ignited the research concept, total paradigm change in the research concept, starting from the communication theory itself. You revisit the information theory and communication theory, already Shannon has led. From there the question has started. So how to give all this if we are not revisiting the fundamental theory by ourselves? Okay, so the problem is not only for the phi, only for the fundamental communication theory, only for the MAC, only for the on the network. It's a problem as a whole. Okay, but demand is there. There is no way to get rid of it.
Are you
on, you know, Li-Fi? Yes, Li-Fi is there, LiFi is becoming a part of our integrated part of the whole system. That's why I kept the optical communication part also there. But if you, for your information, if you have some time also, we have a very nice Harvard lab here, where actually he is a postdoc from the school, and he is also associated with that lab. If some of you are interested, we can show you the hardware also. They are lying and working over the LiFi communication. So here, how much time we will get to explain all that, we don't know. But definitely, that setup, wireless setup, if you are interested, you can see and get some knowledge from the students. Okay. In terms of the overview, if we start with the WLAN. WLAN actually, the 5 technologies started with 11, only 11, then 11B, A, G, N and SE, remember. Up to B, we were in the single carrier communications, spectrum based communication was there in the system. And from 11A onwards, we started with multi carrier communication, well known in the terms of a orthogonal frequency division multiplexing. How in the 5 year we increase the data rate suddenly is because we switched from the single carrier to orthogonal frequency division multiplexing concept. If you move, actually, it is not only the 5 layer technology, we also tried to increase the bandwidth allocation, and so the capacity in terms of the bandwidth in the transmitter as well as the receiver, that also we tried to increase. So high data rate always is directly related with the bandwidth you are getting for the operation. So in that sense, it is not only the modulation, it is the allocation of the bandwidth per channel, per communication we have tried to increase. Top of that, finally, the concept of the MIMO communication we have integrated. So WLAN could give the data rate from 1 Mbps, 2 Mbps, which was the very fast generation, to towards this much high. See, actually, for beyond AC, there is another stuff that already came up, is the 11AD, which is mainly the millimeter wave based communication, where this 10 Gbps over wireless is the kind of your integration and intention. And already some of the chips who are demonstrated in the industry, and they are always already in the market based on the 11AD. We will show you the products. And frequency band, see, they were the all the license free zone, mainly in the 2.4, 11A was in the 5, 11AC also is dedicatedly over the 5 gigahertz band, AD is dedicated to 60 gigahertz, but remember his control signal, for the its control signal, we switched to 5. I told right that we have to change the control signal and the data signal. So that we have dedicatedly changed the control signal channel, the bandwidth of the channel itself is different for AD. Okay. Actually, switching between 5 to 2.4 gigahertz, that option is also there in 11N. Realizing that if we can send the control signal a little bit separately, we are gaining somewhere. So they can switch. Also, they can switch for the data transmission from 5 gigahertz to 2.4 gigahertz. 5 gigahertz, the bandwidth is high. So even if you are seeing that that band is totally congested, there is an option given by WLAN that you switch to 2.4 gigahertz legacy network and transmit there. Okay, it depends. He has given you the flexibility in terms of choosing the user. What do you want? I can see, tell you the available channels. I can tell you the bandwidth that they can support. I can tell you the quality of service you can get based on my interference profile, what I can see as sitting from AP. So now you select to switch between 2.4 to 5 gigahertz band. So that is possible. In terms of the frequencies that we are utilizing, and in terms of the bandwidth per standard that we are utilizing, this figure is talking about, and this is the data rate support that we are getting. Remember, this AC and your 5 gigahertz band AC, he is having the flexibility, maximum flexibility of using all these different kind of the channel widths. So now see, if you are actually transmitting only some voice signals, you will prefer to give him a 20 megahertz channel. If you are transmitting some video signals or streaming online, then you prefer to go for 160 megahertz or 80 megahertz channel. even for 160 megahertz channel, there is an option that you break it in the 80 megahertz, 80 megahertz, wherever necessary you just do the aggregation. Okay. So, the flexibility that I am talking today, already it has been come up as a standard and came into people's mind, and some solutions are available. So, do not allocate, do not have a same bandwidth channels is the first crucial way, and keep it open for aggregation of the channel data somehow, how that mechanism will work, how MAC will allocate all those channels, multiple bandwidth channels to you. And actually remember, what is your priority in terms of your quality of service and the latency, what kind of the application for which you are asking me the channel, all that information you have to give to the AP, then only he will start scheduling you. Otherwise DJs, people are not, AP are also intelligent, they are not allocating you the channels and the communication path free, easily available. This is one way, the 2.4 gigahertz bandwidth WLAN establishes and extends. The suppose I have there is the concept of primary and secondary channels, and within that in the 2.4 gigahertz there are 13 channels available. Okay. And if you see the placement of those 13 channels, you will see that at least 3 AP within a zone can be turned on and can operate in an interference free. You see the channel numbers 1, 6 and 11. Okay. So, they are bandwidth, the channel bandwidths are selected in such a way, these channels, each of them are having a 20 megahertz wide, they are 25 megahertz apart. So, 5 megahertz bandwidth gap is there. So, you can imagine that at least interference free transmission I can expect if I select 1, 6 and 11 AP to cover this area. What will happen if that is not possible? I mean the fourth AP needs to be turned on because number of the users are high. Okay. So, then whenever you are doing it, so you remember that the concept of the primary secondary channel concept is coming up. So, if your primary channel is heavily blocked, then only you can switch to the secondary channel. What will be the allocation of the secondary channel is the plan. So, for each and every channel, if it is a working as primary channel, he is having associated secondary channel. Okay. But remember this primary secondary channel allocation with that plan you have deployed one AP. Now, if you wish to extend the zone, if you wish to connect that AP with another AP and forming a best BSS, so then you have to clearly understand whether all the users of the next AP, they are using the same kind of the structure or not. If they are using the same primary and user secondary user channel concept, you cannot join with him. Okay. You try to identify such a set where actually those two primary secondary channels are orthogonal to your primary secondary channel user, otherwise you are going to face huge interference and the communication will be heavily disturbed in your extension. So, this extension itself, then how these two AP will know each other? Nice concept WLAN has given us that these two APs, they can talk to each other in the MAC layer. So, when they are talking to each other in the MAC layer, each of them are sharing the information about their primary secondary channel, capacity, number of the density of the users, coverage zone, interference profile. So, each everything is shared, whether joining is possible or not, that will be decided by them. Okay? And then the joining will happen. So, association, I should say deassociation, reassociation, these are the terms usually getting added with the users as well as for the extension of the network. And these terms will be really very important if the flexibility comes into picture. Sometimes you are joining with him, sometimes you are breaking the connection, joining with somebody else for the sake of the extension, for the sake of the kind of the operation that you need to support. Sharing the resources, wherever you need the extra resource, you are going to share. So, how are you sharing, what principal basis you are sharing is a very nice idea and very nice area to research. So, how to go ahead with this sharing and joining, how, what, based on what principle this joining will happen. This is a very basic slides of the orthogonal frequency division multiplexing. I do not wish to talk much about this, which was a key enabler for us when we hiked, we switched for the high data rate. Orthogonal frequency division multiplexing basically is a frequency division, but overlapping the frequency zones in terms, because the carrier signals that we are utilizing for the transmission, they are orthogonal to each other. If the carrier signals are orthogonal to each other, over the they can share actually some amount of the spectrum, and best we by means of that we could actually provide the spectrum, increase the spectrum efficiency, and hence the data rate also. They are having lot of plus points and the negative points related to this orthogonal frequency division multiplexing based transmission. Major advantage is that your high spectral efficiency and high data rate, but disadvantage is like the inter symbol interference, inter carrier interference, and your subband spacing, guard band. It is a separate path of the research itself on the wave DMS. So this is just to make you familiar that this is the technology used in the file layer. Similarly, MIMO concept is also already there to enhance the data rate. So, MIMO case actually, how many number of the transmitters are taking part in the communication system today, that also today you can make flexible, but it is not there till now in the standard. I should say, if the standard is supporting you 4 cross 4 and 8 cross 8 structure and 2 cross 2 structure, so either you are choosing a 2 cross 2 or 4 cross 4 or 8 cross 8 kind of. Tomorrow you will be dynamically choosing the antenna structure. Okay. So, MIMO is there already, and MIMO in a flexible mode is coming up. These are the protocol layer and messaging that happens. You understand this LLC is above the MAC, higher layer MAC, who is actually sending this MSDU packets to the MAC and MAC to MAC. This is a common structure of the OSI layer. Two APs can actually talk over this MAC to MAC layer. Phi to phi communication is possible. This cross layer communication like that is not allowed till now, but actually within a node, MAC to phi and phi to MAC like that is a common messaging type till now that is there. So, that stuff we have not broken up, that phi of one node is suddenly talking with the MAC of the another node, because both the way the protocol system, that is not possible. I do not know whether what will happen in future, but till now it is not possible. This is a very important concept to understand the way WLAN works, to make you clear the way all the other short range communications will work. This is called basic service station or BSS. BSS can have the architecture like this, where the two nodes can talk to each other without any AP. Fine. Sometimes I wish to transfer you something. Why should I go via AP and via the cellular networks? Who will take care of my latency and my energy consumption and all? I don't want. I just wish to get connected to you, talk to you. It is a local connection required. Fine. So that structure is there. We call it infrastructure less BSS. This is an infrastructured BSS, where you will find that there is a AP and there are multiple stations, and all the stations talk to each other via AP. So, all the scheduling, all the energy resource allocation and all, it will be done via AP. Okay. If two BSS are connected to each other, we call the set as extended SS. This is called ESS. And how actually the distribution of the resource, who will take care of? Two APs, they should be connected via the distribution DS. These are distributed servers. So, those will be taking care of the total resource management of the two BSS. Remember one thing, here it is very easy to get connected to the internet. Here you would not be able to get connected to the internet, but it depends on the fact whether you at all wish to get that kind of service or not. I should say, there should be the provision to get connected to internet or not to get connected to the internet, keeping in mind the future is demanding. Today 11.11 platform, they have come up with a peer to peer communication. So, there you will see that there will be not a station AP kind of, there will be a group owner, but the structure is in this kind of, I mean it is infrastructure less. That group owner will be actually, anybody can be a group owner at any moment, and he can take care of the local communication and all. And if required tomorrow, this group owner will be connected, will be knocking some AP in a special mode, the AP can be connected, but that will be the hired connection. Okay. by demand actually that connection will be set up to the standards infrastructure based BSS, and then actually you can get connected to the internet. But if that service is not required, it is very cost effective. You simply turn off, do not demand it, do not ask for it, and you stay happily inside your own network. So, that is the social network going on. Clear? So, if this is the situation, then the point that I was telling, you have to have the beacons, scanning, authentication, association, and different authentication process. Beacons is such that when AP will should explain and actually broadcast the amount some information about the networks. So, who is where, what kind of the network structure, it is a mesh structure, start structure, base station, IBSS or ESS, where are you, how, what about the, what is the capacity of this typical network, everything is getting actually broadcasted. After it is broadcasting, how a user will know where am I? So, he will keep on actually scanning the spectrum, and he will always listen, he will be always in the listening mode, he will get information that something is getting broadcasted. If you open up the broadcasted packet, you will be able to know how to get yourself associated to this typical kind of the network. You will see that somebody is communicating, he is on inside that network. So, it is a kind of the scanning and also positioning yourself, finding yourself and positioning where are you, where do you wish to get connected. Association basically is related to sending up the request packet that I wish to get associated with you. If AP allows you, you get associated. So, it is the association request and then coming the acknowledgement request based on which you get associated. Understood? Once the association is done, prior to the association, definitely authentication should proceed, right? The authentication is basically a security check these days. So, security check is basically having sharing some of the crucial security information in between to identify that new user getting accommodated in my network, and AP is having the full intelligence and the full authentication and the full authority to identify whether to allow somebody to join or to stop. Fine. After association, you can either have reassociation or deassociation. Can anybody tell me when I will be needing a reassociation? Reassociation means, you mean to say the association to your old AP, right? This is one option. Second option? So, that I actually was there. I was getting connected with my, I was associated. I am asking reassociation. So, he said the possibility that when actually my link failure will happen. I am saying not only the link failure, from yes, one BSS to the next BSS, and both the BSS are in ESS. Got it? Your BSS ID is expected to change when you are moving. So, when we give the ID, no, you will see first ID comes from the ESS, then it, there is a BSS ID, then use your local ID. Okay. So, whenever you are changing the BSS, so every time this is the announcement I was talking about, your presence announcement. So, reassociation is a part of your announcement and your presence. So, if you are moving, then when you are going even out of the ESS, okay, but this ESS is having some connection with the other ESS. So, he should be informed that somebody is leaving my area and he may be actually getting reassociated to you. It is a continuous tracking process also. Okay. Tracking is done usually for a very important user, or sometimes to track somebody who is fishy for me. So, it is a part of the security also sometimes, I should say. So, that is a reassociation going on. Deassociation is something you are actually declaring that my purpose is over. If you are a good user, you should inform that my purpose is over. And sometimes people do not do it, most of the time people do not do it. That is why as a protocol itself, priority AP is asking to declare you for how much time actually you are going to block the channel. He also calculates based on the data packets you need, based on the data rate that you are allocated to allow to use the channel. And beyond that, if some extra request is there and based on the priority level, if even if he is accommodating you, he will be actually giving you the chance for the deassociation, and he will be forcefully deassociating you. If you are not giving some special request in between that I wish to extend my connection, you may be actually drop your communication for this moment and he will tell you to get connected after some time. Okay, that is possible. So, deassociation is something else, and reassociation is actually to track your mobility mainly. Authentication. This process itself became more and more stringent with respect to the service providing and security issues. This is a typical kind of the handover that happens in the WLAN. So, authentication first sent from the STA, it is a request, I wish to get connected. So, AP also says that okay, I am authenticating, I can identify because seeing the past record of yours. Association request only can come if once your authentication is proved, and then actually yeah, association response is there. See, this EAP request identity and all, this is a WEAP kind of, this is a protocol for exchanging the security information. It is a security information about the network. When you have got the association, you are responsible to keep the security of the record of the network, and the way you should exchange the information, the kind of the encryption key you should be using to encrypt your data, all those information is coming up. See, if I tell you the protocol, that protocol if you know, you will be knowing what are the exact rules and regulations for that protocol of encrypting and decrypting my messages. The key messages, there are having a four kind of sharing. I am not going to the detail of all that right now. Very rough idea, the way actually the medium access is happening. I understood that I have got the association. How to now get the channel to transfer my data? See, if this is the total time period, prior to that when medium was busy, if you can sense the medium is busy, how will you sense the medium is busy? Sense the channel, measure the power, as simple as that. You measure the power from the channel, if the power is pretty high, you will understand somebody is talking, somebody has engaged it. If I try to transmit now forcefully, my data will be lost and I will be interfering also somebody. If you are a jammer, you will try to do that. If you are not a jammer, good user, you won't be able to, you won't be able to do it also. So, once medium has turned from busy to the ideal state, medium is transferring from busy to ideal means now it is your turn to make him busy. Okay? So, what the way we do it is, we first send some the burst response access, for example, acknowledgement, the CTS, RTS, CTS informations, for all those actually we keep a very small amount of the burst transmission time period within which, because these are the control information that are passing through the channel. And after passing all that, there is a period where we really struggle for the channel. We will come to that point. And if I am getting once the channel, acquired the channel, so between actually the first priority use and the second packet that needs to be going on, it is a PCF kind of the transmission and the protocol that is going on. Between two PCF sessions, there are some small session associated for the control signals, which is called the PIFS. And next, DIFS is a period that is basically telling you some slot times and multiple SIFS times, after which the DIFS is a time where actually you should start again struggling and fighting for the channel. Question is, I do not know who else are asking for the channel as a user. For APE, it is very hard to identify whom should I give priority, whom should I not. Okay? So, let them fight and let them acquire the channel. This is the strategy of WLAN. What they do is, initially for the control portion, they take or exchange all this information, and they, everybody knows that once the DIFS period is over, now I can start fighting for the channel. How that fighting will happen, see, it is very interesting. So, station 1, station 2, station 3, station 4, all are having frame to start the transmission. Okay? So, first station 1, suppose his frame was getting transmitted, his transmission is over. Then after the DIFS period, somebody can start doing the transmission, that is the situation. So, situation is first station A got the channel, he has started the transmission, his transmission is over, everybody knows because you are sensing the channel, you suddenly came to know that the transmission is over, channel is free, but immediately you should not start the fight. Then the rule is you please wait for a short period which is called DIFS. After DIFS also people are not starting the communication. What they are doing? They have set up a random backoff. What is this backoff? Backoff means there is a period for the time that you have to DIFS, you have to wait for. There is a window for this choosing any time for you. That's a random. So, I don't know who else are there in the network fighting with me. I will choose some, pick up some numbers, say 0 to 9, 10 seconds are there. I may pick up 1, I may pick up 10 also. I don't know. So, randomly everybody picks up and for that they have to wait. Whoever has picked up the minimal among all of them, definitely that random period will be over, his backup will be over immediately. And even then if he sees that there is nobody in the channel, immediately he gets the chance to acquire the channel. That is the rule. So, like that station 3 next got the chance to acquire the channel. That is highly impossible because that is a random thing, but chance is there that if the density of the network is really high, then more than one people can choose the same vector. So, once even they start doing it, there will be high correlation, I mean the interference will be extremely high, and once receiving the fact, both of them will realize that retransmission is required. So, next cycle both of the packet will be discarded, next cycle immediately they will pick up something else. But for that moment, the transmission is not fruitful. Definitely, but actually when we are choosing the random, setting our vectors, this is a nav we are setting. So, that network vector whenever we are setting, fundamental randomness is enough to do it. But queuing, it is centrally actually allocating the channel, then applying the queuing theory for all that, that works there. But it is completely contention based, actually you start fighting among each other and we rely completely on the probability theory. It is the randomness that leads the transmission mechanism and it works really very nice. Never it is possible that nobody got the channel, okay. And this time periods and all are set so nicely that if you will get the chance after small period. What question is something like this, what will happen? Suppose this guy, he set his nav here, he did not get the chance to transmit, again he saw that somebody has acquired the channel. Whenever somebody is acquiring the channel, you got the news because you are continuously measuring the channel, gone. So, there is no meaning of actually now counting down. After setting the vector, you are counting down, no chance to count down, you stop there. And then again, you are starting when you got the chance to count, start counting once again. You will start from the last point, okay. So, nobody knows how far you progressed also. Is it clear? So, this guy after the third trial only he got the chance. So, he was the guy who took the maximum time, set the maximum time for his nav. But remember, this is the one way of avoiding the interference and also cooperating with each other. You should not lose your patience that I am not getting the chance at all to acquire the channel, okay. This is a cooperativeness that has to be maintained actually for allowing the multiple access or accommodating the multiple access condition inside the channel. There is another option WLAN gave us, which is called the contention based and contention free kind of communication. Contention free period means whole time period basis MAC will actually divide the contention free and the contention best both. So, whenever the contention free period is coming up, he will be giving the channel to a particular guy who was in the queue. Here actually your queuing can come into picture, queuing the users who has asked for only the contention free based communication. I never wish to fight with anybody. Whenever my contention free period will come, you just queue me and tell me, I will just send my stuff. Otherwise, you either you can go for that mode or you go for the contention based kind of communication, or somebody can switch also. Sometimes you are using the contention free, sometimes you are using the contention based kind of transmission. The options are open. This is the way actually the acknowledgement comes forward. Here, this is we are ending with the fundamental understanding of the way flexibility, communication, and the way actually the cooperation is possible, and the one example the WLAN has already set up. Correct. Definitely, these are all the analysis part that you are talking about. See, there is something called CW, the contention window, and we have something called contention minimum window and contention window maximum. This minimum and maximum, what should be for a typical technology, is fixed by the standardization. Okay. So, if you are seeing that always I am fixing to the CW max, you can choose any value between 0 to CW max. I am choosing always CW max and continuously I am failing to get the channel. If this happens, AP will have a look into it. So, then you can go for the contention free base period priority based selection and queuing, and then you can get the channel also based on that. Okay. Priority based transmission is something else. If we are going for a priority based classification, that 11AC also supports. For priority based transmission, we prefer to go for the contention free. Do not come for the contention based. Who will schedule you? Who will take care of your priority? If the priority is there, definitely actually AP will put you in the slot of the contention free. True, that they do. Either actually he centrally schedule it, or you give some distribution for the, you are saying that actually the distribution for contention, that is the concept of contention within the contention free period. So, going from here, the high throughput whatever we are asking for, where WLAN is standing is, for high throughput 5, which is a part of this whole short range communication to discuss about, this AC, 11AC was the first standard which came up with the concept of very high throughput, I should say. In that 11AC, what the amendment they did, they included very wide bandwidth. I already told you guys that 64 different kind of the bandwidths I showed, right? Mainly this 80 megahertz and 160 megahertz, and switching between 80 to 160 megahertz is the key enabler for 11AC to boost up the data rate from whatever was there in 11N. And modulation coding, that also they went for the higher modulation part. Spatial streaming, it means the increase in not only implementing MIMO, increasing the MIMO rate, I mean the number of the antennas in the MIMO structure, they went for up to 8x8 MIMO to give the support. And the channel bandwidth was expanded to include the 80 megahertz, 160 megahertz waveforms. So, these are the key enablers. So, remember, you need the bandwidth, you need the MIMO, you need the higher modulation schemes, you need a transmission scheme which is a spectrally efficient like wave DM, okay? At least in the 5 layer. These are the channels. So, see anything can be done with this 80 and 160 megahertz channels, and any jumping aggregation, that is the plan for the WLAN AC. So, from here quickly we should enter into the other technologies, starting with the ultra wideband. See, this concept of 160 megahertz were there with us, right? When ultra wideband came for the commercial use in 2002, ultra wideband was there for the defense use. They used to use it for the radar communication, short duration pass they used to transmit to detect the object. When FCC opened it up for the commercial use, they gave a license free band first of all. Amazing stuff what they did, they opened up first time in the means field of communication, they opened up 7 gigahertz bandwidth. People were so shocked, they were actually means aware of handling megahertz in the terms of 100 or actually 160 mega, then also how to manage the design, make the system power efficient and all was the question. Suddenly ultra wideband came into picture with a 7 gigahertz bandwidth available. People did not know at all how to use this wide bandwidth in the system design and make an efficient communication. What they did is they came up with a fast level of the bandwidth usage which was based on up to 1.5 gigahertz. We will utilize for the first generation out of this whole 7, 1.5 gigahertz. So, UWB communication whatever is available till now, they are based on the first generation 1.5 gigahertz. Even that 1.5 gigahertz, the question was, fine, you can get a very wide bandwidth, but your FCC told the transmission power of yours should be minus 41.5 dBm per megahertz. Minus 41.5 dBm per megahertz, it means your signal is buried in noise. Okay? Challenge came from where? You have a very, very huge bandwidth. Per megahertz, the power level transmission is buried in noise. So, you have to integrate in the receiver over the bandwidth to boost up your channel signal power. Otherwise, how the detection will go on? What kind of signal processing you will do sitting if you actually if you cannot detect your signal at all which is buried in noise. So, here the problem of the bandwidth was not there, problem was how to handle that bandwidth given the constraint of very low power transmission. So, these are the very fundamental way, the way you can define a signal as ultra wide band signal. In GIST actually if any signal, technical term is if any signal is having its absolute bandwidth greater than 500 megahertz, we call it a ultra wideband signal, fine. So, UWB devices initially came up for below 960, 3.1 to 10.6, vehicular radar system for 2029, but we are interested here where FCC gave us full 7 gigahertz for the transmission. UWB was not a very successful technology because of lot of the technical issues that the companies started and they did not actually made the standardization happen, but it was a very big boom and it gave us a very lot of promises, number huge amount of the promises. Actually till now the people research in the UWB is not totally off, it is there, lot of applications are also there and it is the standard is not via IEEE. It is via the ECMA, it is the European group who has standardized the specification. We will be ending up with 110, okay. So, these are the promises, very low power because your transmission power is very less, cost will be very low, very high data rate solution possible because you have huge bandwidth, you should just need to know how to use that bandwidth. That is a signal processing problem, that is not the bandwidth problem. That is a signal processing problem. So, if you are a good researcher, system designer, you can do it. That was the trust. And possible data rates were 53.3 Mbps to 480 Mbps. Then they extended slowly, they extended the data rate and they tried to increase the range also. When it ended up, second generation UWB promised they could demonstrate 1 Gbps communication at least over 20 meters. First generation demonstrated 600 Mbps up to 20 meters, 10 meters. Second generation they could come up with a 1 Gbps also with a 20 meter distance and it was sufficient. Why I am saying? Because your USB port and all it will be, it was actually UWB enabled. The high definition streaming and all the data rate was not an issue then. 600 Mbps I am getting over wireless. So, it was a very big achievement that day compared to the WLAN achievements. These are a very typical CHARP based modulated UWB signal and UWB could coexist also with others. Why you know? UWB signal is buried in noise, it can never give you any interference. It was ready to accept interference if I utilize UWB with WLAN somehow, because you have seen right, UWB is operating over 3.1 to 10.6. So, 5 gigahertz WLAN is standing in between. So, WLAN power transmission is really very high, UWB power transmission is buried in noise. So, there is no point to be worried by WLAN that I will be interfered by UWB. So, they could never give any objection. But UWB has the chance that very high power interference is expected to come to WLAN, and WLAN was the first priority user of their group. WLAN was not ready to give you any sacrifice in terms of power transmission. So, UWB told, okay, fine, I will handle the interference somehow by means of the signal processing techniques and the MAC techniques. So, that was the way. It was with a very good spirit actually the technology started up. Applications people saw like this. So, all this wireless communication between the scanner, camcorder, hard disk, your mobile phone, everything you can do in a smart home concept. So, video streaming like this is possible. Very small range, like the wireless sensor networks, it will be by via UWB, and then this is what the infrastructure based communication going on. UWB, remember, if you are using a very high bandwidth, what will be the in terms of time duration the pulse with this? In the terms of the picoseconds, you go at 1 by 10, 7 gigahertz means in the terms of the picoseconds we are. So, what about the resolution? Very high resolution you can be able to see. So, receiver's zooming capacity has increased like anything. So, he can actually see the signals or the multipaths that are arriving at the gap of picoseconds. Problem is, so nice it is. So, if I can see like that, so suppose there is a crack in the manufacturing process inside a bar of the iron, I can detect it. Suppose something is buried because of the natural disaster, something is buried, I send the signal, he can actually penetrate because my signal is in very high frequency and duration is also small. So, and when the return signal is coming back, right, I can really segregate them out in terms of the very fine time resolution. So, I can see basically that how far is very finely, minutely, I can locate the point where from actually the reflection came back. Okay. So, identification in mines after natural disaster, identification and localization mainly. Localization was very, very, the problems of localization was very, very interested to implement this kind of technology in practice. So, wireless personal area network wise, we have already discussed these are the applications that UWB promised. UWB, apart from this, in the military communication, it was there. Physical layer solution for the sensor networks, it was there. It was replacing the Bluetooth because it was giving the connection with very high data rate with a very low power compared to Bluetooth and WLAN. So, it was there. Physical layer solution for the body area network, and already these chips are available, you know. And I know actually the chip available which will be actually monitoring the heart condition, and they implemented it after just beside the pacemaker they also implemented the chip, and they could get very nice data collected on the watch that you are wearing on the on your wrist, and that data automatically getting communicated to the cellular world and to your doctor to actually identify the heartbeats of yours, and the resolution was so nice. Very nicely they could detect all that, and so it was a very big success. And if you see the IEEE standardization, you will see that the standards are talking about the UWB based physical layer for the WLAN for the implant devices. High precision ranging geolocation already we have discussed, and the emergency communication. UWB networks can be developed by an ad hoc basis. Okay, power consumption is really very less. So, very fast you can form the network, and communication is also possible after the disaster has happened. Okay. You do not need a very huge amount of the power backup to start the network. So, it was a very big plus point for emergency handling. These were the challenges. I told that coexistence with this WLAN was a main problem. Multipath, if it is a very dense multipath channel, to recover your signal itself is a very big issue. Interference from, because your coexistence is related with this guy, you see interference from the not only WLAN, other UWB networks, if you are getting lot of the interference, signal processing is a really very, very big tie for your own UWB. and the clock speed. You remember, now you are designing a circuit who is having the bandwidth of 500 megahertz at least. So, the ADC required versus the speed of ADC required. At least 1 Gbps. So, the power consumption inside ADC, how to control that is the issue. Who will actually now give you a 1 Gbps ADC? More the ADC speed is, power consumption is high, cost is exponentially high, but you are promising a low cost design solution. So, ADC became a very big headache for the system designers. So, the area like your compression sensing based transmission and the data detection, all those research actually were enriched when this problem came up. Handling the ADC, lowering the bit resolution inside ADC and then still recovering the problem, recovering your data at the output of the decoder, those kind of the problems were very, very important in the context of UWB transmission. So, these are the very brief comparative study between the Bluetooth, UWB, Zigbee and the Wi-Fi. I request you to quickly go through it. It is a summarizing all the plus points and negative points and the key features of all those technologies. Quickly, we will enter into the Bluetooth, where the hand-free operations we these days are very well known about. We utilize them in the car, Professor Datta was telling in the morning. We utilize them actually for the inside home also for lot of the studies. The Bluetooth based watch these days are helping you to get connected wirelessly over your cellular connection. Internet of the things, remote control, telehealth, telemedicine world and the real time localization, everything is now, as UWB was not clicking that time, it was a completely failed technology almost people believe in. So, Bluetooth market is still on. These are the traditional versus the low energy Bluetooth. I should say that Bluetooth has incorporated very successfully all the demand of the network that I was explaining in the morning, that you should have a nice transition between the selection from the ideal to the sleep, waking up from the sleep, power energy consumption mechanisms not only in the PHY, also in the MAC perspective. So, Bluetooth address all of them one by one, and when they came up with the Bluetooth with the low energy condition, this was basically targeting the Internet of the Things market, where actually the power consumption they hugely brought it down with the constraint that the data rate support can be little bit low, quality of the service cannot be that much high that the normal Bluetooth gives you. But it was fine for the wireless sensor networks and the Internet of Things, where actually only the burst transmission is possible, which is required, and whether you can with moderate quality of the service, you can actually allow me the transmission or not. So, Bluetooth extended the zone in that area. So, Bluetooth based networks these days, social network that I was talking about, that is already developed in the Aalborg University, it is working in the Aalborg University, where actually all the users of the Aalborg University and their social media networks, they are enabled with their kind of the software developed based on the Bluetooth, acquiring the information about who you are and whom you are meeting over the day, automatically uploading all those information to your Facebook profile. That is automatically happening. So, they could show it. This coin cell battery is a concept of just a one rupee coin, this you have seen the shape of that and the size of that, the battery will be maximum of that size. So, that battery actually having lot of restriction also in terms of the usages, and this Bluetooth low energy enabled the research of this coin cell battery and got the application there, where actually this less than 20 milliampere peak current and less than 5 microampere average current was achievable. It enabled that technology research and we could develop actually that coin cell battery. This is the basically channelization process in the whole same 2.4 gigahertz Bluetooth is operating with WLAN, and he is having a 2 megahertz wide channel, 40 such channels he is having you have the opportunity to switch over the channels, dynamically giving you the opportunity for utilizing those channels. And transmission power, transmission scheme that they use is the GFSK kind of scheme, and it is not the WebDM based, because I said actually that Bluetooth should not be power hungry. WebDM requires some power hungriness, and the designs of the front end circuits like the amplifiers and the filters to manage your PAPR stuff, you need actually special power hungry algorithms that side. That is not possible, so they have come up with the GFSK. Quickly going inside the Zigbee is a low data rate solution. If I ask you to compare between the Bluetooth and the Zigbee, Bluetooth low end and Zigbee almost they are giving the same solution. So that's why people, based on actually the availability of the devices in the market, you will not see much Zigbee devices here and there. The Bluetooth low end version has actually taken the market for this Zigbee, wherever Zigbee was working. So operation wise, data rate wise, the MAC channel access wise, everything is almost same. These are the typical features that Zigbee uses. The network structure is something like this, where the star and the mesh kind of the network, ad hoc network, can be easily framed, can be easily framed by Zigbee, and dynamically they can be set. Okay, who will be the central point of coordinator, who will be the forming the star, who will be forming the mesh, that flexibility was addressed in the Zigbee a priori. So from Zigbee itself, actually later on people hired it for the other short range communications. Channelization again, this is the last figure of this talk, and it is giving a very important message. Message means, what is the future for this Bluetooth and Zigbee? Is there any usage, or it is going to die? Situation is, 2015 wise I got the message, I mean all the information about. See, up to 2015 it was seen that it is a continuous, it is an, it's not a pure linear, it is an exponential increase in the demand of this low power short range technologies like Zigbee and your Bluetooth. And what are the usage, starting from transportation, agriculture, consumer market, medical, smart meeting, industrial automation, building automation, home networking, everywhere, home automatic networks, wherever you see. So these days the leading technologies are Bluetooth, apart from WLAN. WLAN is covering the wider zone. So Zigbee Bluetooth is the zone where actually this flexibility fast needs to be incorporated very fast. Okay, so remember, the Bluetooth evolution is still going on, standard from standard perspective, and there actually this is a flexible actually the area where actually in future, if they are getting stuck because their bandwidth is small, getting stuck to give you the very high data rate like your Gbps, they are the millimeter wave technologies will come and fill up the gaps. Okay, but till now there are the applications where actually the Zigbee Bluetooth requirements will keep on going, expected to grow up. Fine. Any query? See, if you see the classical Bluetooth and the classical Zigbee, so there actually the data rate wise there is a difference. Bluetooth provides the higher data rate than the Zigbee. Okay, power consumption wise, if you see, Zigbee power consumption is really very less. Zigbee was actually initially designed to accommodate the technology for wireless sensor networks. When sensor networks came up, what will be the technology, 5-layer technology for that? Zigbee came up. Okay, and so that time sensor networks was envisaged to transfer the data in the terms of very few kilobit per second, and then you need a very simple 5-layer to transmit them. So they are the position of Zigbee. Bluetooth was not like that. Bluetooth was actually like ultra wideband, a little bit higher data rate. So communication to the WLAN, how it will happen, but with the typical moderate kind of the data rate was expected. So the bandwidth was allotted very high. Technology wise actually it was little bit complicated. So that was the difference there. Then Bluetooth realized that Zigbee market is also growing up. So sensor network is growing up. So why not to provide the low power solution of the Bluetooth, addressing the low power and the low data rate, and capture the market of Zigbee. That has happened. Now if I compare the Bluetooth low power and the Zigbee, not much difference is there. Okay. Rather, I should say ZigBee will be restricted, because in the way it started, after some time it cannot give you the higher data rate, but Bluetooth can give, because Bluetooth has evolved with a low power version as well as traditional Bluetooth can give you higher data rate. Okay. So, he can access the both. Sorry, I couldn't hear the question. UWB is by default an anti-jamming technique, by default I should say, because anyway your signal is buried in noise.